You know.
I just got an
Remember the
urge
day.
to start singing like Eddie Vedder. I don't know why.
These things happen. All right, we're live. Let's get started in the traditional fashion.
It's going to happen throughout the show tonight.
Here comes. Yay, us.
Yay.
All right. Yay, us. Okay. Yay. Welcome, everybody. Here we go again. And for tonight's feature film, we have the wonderful and marvelous Kent Hovind, Creation Seminar.
Yay.
Lies in the Textbooks. That's what this one's called, Lies in the Textbooks.
Republican American don't like education, so get on school.
Do we know the date on this one?
He make creation books, so kids get dumb.
All right. All righty then. Shall we commence? Let's see.
Oh, let's.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. I almost hit Battleship Apologetics again. We'll save
don't
that
you
for.
Do that to me.
If anybody nods off, we'll save that to wake him up. All right. Here comes Mr. Hovind.
Dr. Hovind taught science for 15 years. Then he got his PhD in education.
Drink.
He's
drink. Drink.
Already? All right.
Don't you dare call him a doctor. Don't you dare call him a doctor. That is our word. It's our word.
Okay. Kanatis, that is. I'm sorry. That is negative 10 net points. You failed to identify yourself so that viewers would know who is doing the talking.
This is Kevin.
RJ here. If I may say a little word about Dr. Hovind's fabulous educational career.
Please do.
He has a PhD from the magnificent Patriot University, which operates out of a barn on the outskirts of a city in Colorado. I've seen pictures of it.
I have as well.
And I believe it or not, actually seen his PhD doctoral thesis, which is a rib tickler if you want to look at how not to do an actual PhD thesis, especially since he apparently didn't put the spell checker on when he wrote it.
Not only that, there's no page numbers.
Well, you know, counting up all those number things can get really troublesome. If
that's hard to count to 40.
See, if it was numbered just up to page 10, I'd understand.
I think there's only six pages, though.
All right.
But look how cute Eric is.
He looks like a kid.
This was maybe done about 10 years or more ago, maybe before Daddy
before, Pete went to before jail. Yeah.
Yes.
So 2004, 2005, maybe.
Indeed, and and Kent is still saying the same things. I hope everybody's seen that lovely song by Eddie Goomba. I would not play it on our show because it would take away from his channel. You know what? I'll put a link. I will put a link in the description to that song. I just love it. All right, let's
is
let
that the Logic opening song.
Yeah. Yes, that's the one. Okay. All right. Let's see how. Young man Eric does the intro to Dad. Here we go.
He's always had a love for teaching, but one thing that he's discovered is that in many of the science textbooks across America today, there are some fallacies, some false information being presented. Why is this information in the science textbooks? What are they trying to prove? Hi, my name is Eric, and in this seminar called Lies in the Textbooks, you're going to find out some of those lies that are being presented and what you can do about it.
All right, here we go.
Well, welcome to our seminar on lies in the textbooks. My name is Kent Hovind. I taught high school science for 15 years. And now since 1989, I've been doing seminars on creation, evolution, and dinosaurs. And our goal is to strengthen your faith in God's Word. Now, this is not my wife. That's just a picture of her.
Drink.
We live in Pensacola, Florida. Been there 16 years. Have three children.
All right. You're up.
He's very correct in saying that is not his wife.
But it's a picture of her.
But she has left him. I was also, and of course Eric has left. So none of these people talk to each other anymore. And she's married to a new person who is an anti-vaxxer who makes her living selling anti-vax stuff. So that's fun.
Joyous. All right.
Also, I'll just toss in the fact that he fancies himself a dinosaur expert. I'm just salivating at the prospect that he may actually mention dinosaurs, since that is an area about which I am more than casually familiar.
What are the odds? All right. Let's let him continue and see what he comes out with.
Beach. And I got them all married and the dog died. Praise God. So I'm home free. And as we mentioned earlier, we have four grandkids so far, and that's God's reward for not killing your own kids when you thought about it. So we got a whole tribe, and they all live right around me and all work in our ministry. It's a real blessing to all have them right there. God's given us an amazing staff of people at Creation Science Evangelism. Our purpose is to get people saved. Okay? We like science at our place. We have Dinosaur Adventure Land. We have a science center, a theme park, and a museum, all kinds of cool science stuff. Some people try to say, well, you Christians are against science. No, I like science. I'm against evolution because it's not part of science.
There we go. All right, who called it first?
I called it first.
Go ahead.
I was going to go back because I just had to Google. I had to look it up because he said, and I didn't know, he said he was a high school science teacher.
Mm-hmm.
He was a high school science teacher at a Baptist school. He never taught real science.
Okay.
Yeah. Can,
RJ, I cede the rest of my time.
Yeah. Parker, the creationist, also has kind of a similar resume, but I was just going to pop in to note that his creationist theme park that he had there completely fizzled when he went into the slammer and he could no longer find creative accounting and tax rules to be able to do it. Although he is trying, now that he's out of jail, he's actually trying to make another one. He's bought some land down there in, I don't think it's in Pensacola anymore. I think it's in some other spot, but he hasn't actually done anything yet. We'll see how he manages over the next few years.
Oh, he has done something. Are you not following him?
Oh, his Dino Land is in the works.
Oh, it's a whole compound of like a survivalist compound at this point.
Interesting.
Of a bunch of people
what?
Who literally live on this land that they got, and they have Bible studies every night, and it is just the scariest bunch of people who are going to wage war on the government that you have seen. Anyway, it's fun.
Wait, so are we talking like a militia compound?
Yeah. Like, but it's for the kids.
Militia for the kids.
Yeah, that would surprise me given his demographic, but I don't think he's actually done anything that's a paying admission kind of thing where people go in and actually have a theme park experience.
They're building it. And that's their intent. But they are all currently a bunch of survivalists living on this thing, building it. It's something to see.
Come to our militia compound. Bring the kids. We got popsicles.
The tax twaddle that got him in the slammer is from that kind of survivalist anti-government authority group that connects up with that. So it wouldn't at all surprise me that they're getting ready to be gun toters.
All right. Moving up. By the way, did I mention that his session, we can cut it off early so nobody bolt when I say this, but this particular presentation is 2 hours and 47 minutes.
Oh, go fuck yourself.
Oh, nice. Nice. This is what I get for setting up a nice room for everybody to talk. That's what I get. All right, here we go. Moving on.
Evolution's a lie, okay? There's no scientific evidence to back up evolution. We'll get into that in just a minute. Bible says in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not bear false witness. Don't lie.
Proverbs.
Yeah, I had it right over to... I knew somebody was going to call that. Go right ahead. You're up.
That first commandment, Ken, you might want to work on that one there a little bit there, Chief.
To be fair to good old Kent, he believes every bit of twaddle that he says. So from his perspective down there in Kent mind, he is telling you the whole truth completely.
Oh, so his name is Kent. It's Kent with an E. I've been pronouncing it wrong.
Okay.
Yeah, good old Kent.
Oh, come on, people.
Use yes, I got it. Yes, I got it. All right. So
in that whole there's no proof for evolution thing, that's a little bit bizarre, too.
He'll get into details on that foolishness, I'm sure.
But oh, I hate
anyway, so
I'll be comparing this to the 1990s apologetic to see what, if anything, he's actually added. I'm not holding my breath on that one.
Well, see, that's what makes this interesting, is watching a historical one from Kent. We can see how it migrated to the, I mean, we've watched quite a few of Eric's productions on this show in the past. It'd be interesting to see how many things were just copied over and spoken with a different voice, but, you know, are just the same assertions over again. So that's mm-hmm. And so it's, you believe that he believes everything that he says, including, remember, he was in love with that whole water canopy thing. Remember the flood?
Oh yeah. Well, he has the attention span of a gnat in some ways, but retains a lot of his tropes. If you look at his various, there are transcripts, by the way, of a lot of Kent Hovind's stuff that have been posted online, so you can actually go through and examine them slowly and carefully as a scholar would, and you can see he's just got tropes that he just rolls out again and again and again and again and again, mm-hmm. Most of which built off of 1980s and 1990s creationist apologetics, which is his formative years back in that period. So he's not exactly somebody drawing on the latest material. He's tripping over his old stuff.
Mm, indeed. All right. This intro thing is just going to be a bunch of I can see it already. It's just going to be a bunch of quotes from the Bible and stuff like that. I don't know when he's going to get into his actual assertions, but if this drags on too long, we'll jump ahead. Like I said, 2 hours and 47 minutes. Bah. All right, here we go.
Says a false witness shall not be unpunished. He that speaketh lies shall not escape. God hates liars. Bible says they delight in lies. Okay. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A lying tongue, then a couple verses later, a false witness that speaketh lies. Out of the seven things God hates, two of them are liars. He must really hate them. He lists them in there twice. Okay. Jesus said, you have your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he's a liar and the father of it. Now, I like science, and I collect public school textbooks.
Okay. RJ, sounds like you got
it. Yeah, good old RJ here. The important lesson on the structure of his spiel is that it is absolutely religious apologetics. All of the science data, and remember to put that in air quotes, that you're going to presumably hear during the next couple hours, is just window dressing. What you've got here is he starts off with this very downbeat, there's that Satan, it's all part of a nexus of how people are viewed in terms of the Bible or anti-Bible. And this is, I see he's got, looks like there's some slightly younger people down below. I guess if you can see on the pictures there, he's probably got some little dinosaur models on the right-hand side and some graphic material. Oh, and this is the era of a laptop. He's got a laptop on the table, so you can get kind of a sense. This is presumably taking place in a church of some sort. And remember, he went around all over the place on a very frantic lecture schedule, although I don't think he ever got up in my neck of the woods through those years. It was mainly in the Southwest part of the country and Southeast. Anyway, what we've got here, remember, this is intended not as a science exercise, but as a save your soul religion enterprise. That's why all of this stuff comes first for him.
Indeed.
I'm glad you said drink there, RJ, because I was literally choking on the irony when he kept talking about liars.
I know. Well, he doesn't think of it that way. Boy, he is a great defender of science.
It's a rather odd form of science, but okay, here we go. Let's see, what year was this from? This has got to be about, what, 8 or 9 years old?
I would guesstimate 2004 or 5, because he went in the slammer after that.
That's right.
Was in there for the next 10 years. But yet it's advanced enough that he's got some laptops on there. So I'm inclined to think it's from there. If he manages to date any source material, we can kind of pin it down more precisely. But it's going to be like a detective story as we try to figure out what year the twaddle was being presented.
Indeed. All right. Here we go. Maybe you'll get into some of that bad, deceptive textbook stuff.
books. I have hundreds of them from many, many countries, from clear back from 1880, I believe, to 2005. Textbooks. I'm not against science. We happen to really like the subject. We have all kinds of cool science displays at our museum and our science center, and you can come down and visit Dinosaur Adventureland and see for yourself. I am, however, against lying to kids. Now, in the first three videos, we talked about how students are being lied to about the Big Bang. It didn't happen. They're being lied to about the age of the Earth. It is not billions of years old. They're being lied to about the cavemen. There's never been a caveman, unless you mean...
Okay.
RJ here again. Do you realize what we're coming in on part three of presumably the previous ones, I am sure, were equally long 2-hour enterprises. So these poor clowns that have probably come day after day when these things were recorded, if they were recorded in the same spot, have been steeped in hours of Dear Dr. Kent to this stage in here, which means that a lot of the people in the audience just may be shell-shocked.
All without smartphones. Like, people couldn't even entertain themselves with smartphones.
Oh, they couldn't even play Words with Friends.
Says join. Hello.
I just approved that kind of on instinct there. Who just joined?
House of Scullis. Say hi.
Ah. Or not.
Nope. Oh,
soon,
okay.
Soon as the mic's working, shout hi. Okay, moving on. We're 3 minutes and 15 seconds in. Kick ass. Here we go.
Osama bin Laden. Okay. They're being lied to about the dinosaurs. They did not live millions of years ago. Now, here we're going to cover about 30 more lies in the textbooks. There are hundreds we could go through. We're going to try to hit the highlights, and this could go for days just covering lies in our textbooks. I'm going to hit some of the big ones, leave some of the little ones go for another time when we have more time. Now, I am not trying to get evolution out of the public schools. I'm not. I think any theory should be allowed
drink,
to be taught.
Drink.
Okay, Canatus, you're up.
This is Kevin. Yes, he is. That's all. That's it. Yeah. He's trying to get evolution out of the schools. Yeah. He lied.
Indeed.
Well, he's a liar.
Well, you know why? Because it's only a theory. It's not a fact yet.
Let me defend Kent before I stab him in the heart.
Okay.
From their perspective, the legal procedure that creationism had to adopt in the 1980s was the equal time approach, because any attempt to simply chuck evolution out of the schools immediately slammed into the Supreme Court. So they began to develop the notion of equal time, that if you're going to present evolution, you have to have creationism too. And then this got modified in the intelligent design era with the same bit where, no, they don't want to get rid of evolution. It should be taught in the schools, but you want to be able to present a controversy about it. You want to be able to have an objective analysis of evidence for and against evolution. And by that time, the 2004-2005 period, when he's operating here, that is in full swing with the intelligent design movement. So
yeah,
he's troping.
I get that's what they were saying. I'm just saying that's not what they meant.
Not with wedge strategy.
Yeah,
agree
that all evolution evidence is false. And when you look at other teachers, we have to remember 15% of American high school science teachers are young earth creationists in public schools.
That's horrible.
And so there's going to be little baby Kent Hovinds, some of whom, in fact, Hovind for their air quote science information. The freshwater case that was covered back that just ended in a court case last year was a long-term thing of a guy who was getting stuff from Kent Hovind apologetics. So if even though you may quite rightly have steam coming out of your ears when you're watching Kent Hovind's videos, make no mistake about it. There are millions of people, including people who are teaching school, who think this guy knows what he's talking about.
That's terrifying.
And how far be it from me to be cynical, but his income would be slashed to nothing, or would have been at the time, if the stuff had been taught in schools. Like, he made his money because this stuff was banned.
Exactly.
I actually don't necessarily agree that he believed it all either. I mean, it's hard when someone's income is entirely based on, you know, saying that it's true. It's hard to be certain about that.
Well, that's what I was mentioning earlier. Some of the stuff he's put forth did seem pretty hard to believe. Like I mentioned, the water canopy thing. That's what caused the flood. Not taking into account the amount of energy that would have been released and, you know, boil the planet. But anyway,
well, you have to remember when this guy is coming from. As the vast majority of secondary redactor creationists, their brains petrified when they read their first creationist material. And in his case, this is back in the 70s and 80s when he was having his formative years. That was the dogma that was floating around. There was, in addition to the vapor canopy idea, there was the ice canopy idea, which was another thing. And so ice blocks were falling down from the heavens. I mean, it's just some hilarious stuff that was going around in creationism in the 1960s. I was alive. In fact, there was my physics teacher in high school, a sweet, brilliant little guy, this little short fellow in a chalk dust covered coat. And he was an excellent physics teacher, but he interrupted our school one day, our class, to talk about the ice canopy theory. And so I realized that this guy is probably a closet creationist. He was a very nice teacher, though, and a very nice, wonderful guy. But that stuff got down by the wayside. It got a lot of criticism, even within the creationist community in the 80s and 90s. So ice canopy, vapor canopy stuff. But the only place you find that stuff today is with your Karl Baugh types or with a Kent Hovind that can't get beyond it. Now you get the fountains of the deep stuff with these funhouse super duper fast plate tectonics with water squishing up and all that kind of stuff. That's the current trope that you find. And it's represented, say, at the Answers in Genesis brand of creationism down there in Kentucky. So we're seeing in many respects a fossilized version of old style creationism that's dressed up in the laptops and the PowerPoints.
Indeed. It's too bad we don't hear much from Nephilim Free anymore. You familiar with him on YouTube? He was the one that apparently the craters on the moon came from the water shooting up from the fountains that are deep.
Yeah, that one is a neat one. Yeah, the craziest one I heard from Henry Morris was that the craters of the moon were caused from lightning bolts that were thrown by the Archangel Michael when fighting Satan in the early days of the Earth.
Wow.
Not to discuss that one later on, but it's in some of his old books from the 1970s.
Well, that's just about as credible as most of the stuff that Mr. Hovind Sr. is going to put out here. And hey, Sean joined. Howdy, Sean. All right. Let us continue.
If you don't have to lie to support your theory with false evidence, okay? I am not trying to get creation into the schools. And I think Christians that work on either one of those are wasting their time. And many people have wasted hundreds of thousands of dollars trying to accomplish those two goals. It's futile. It's not going to happen. I am, however, trying to get lies out of the textbooks. I think we'll find if we take the lies out of the books, there's nothing left to support evolution. Well, that's their problem. They shouldn't have picked such a dumb theory to begin with, okay? It's not my fault, okay? Now, I'm not against teachers. My mother was a godly woman, led my dad to the Lord on their first date. She retired from teaching public school years ago. Been in heaven now for about 7 years. My brother led me to the Lord. He just retired last year from teaching public school after 34 years. There are many good godly teachers in the system. There are many good godly principals, many good godly school board members. I'm not against schools. I'm not against school boards. I'm not against teachers. I'm not against textbooks. I'm against lies. Okay, let's just keep it in perspective. Is there anybody here that thinks teachers or textbooks should be allowed to deliberately lie to students for any reason? And I mean deliberately. They might be lying and not know they're lying, okay, but if they're deliberately lying, that shouldn't be allowed, should it?
Great.
Okay? Wisconsin has a law that requires textbooks.
Oh, I'm sorry, did someone call drink there?
I called a drink on that. Now, in order to lie, it has to be an intentional deception. If they don't understand they're lying or they don't know they're lying, it's not considered a lie. It's just not knowing.
I would agree. Good call.
Yeah, anyone ever said you have a voice for NPR?
I've been told I've had a radio voice by many people.
You'll notice,
you have TV looks.
Poor audience there. When he says no one should be allowed to tell lies, shouldn't it? So he is setting up this thing. It's where he's automatically framing the debate in such a way and prime people to be looking at things that he is saying as lies. Now the part's going to be fun to see what he claims to be a lie and what, if any, evidence that he offers for that. That's where the meat of the matter is going to come in.
That's why I figured by the title this was going to be a good one, just for that reason.
I do have a question for Mr. Hovind, though. He's a firm Bible believer, so he definitely believes that sodomy is a sin, correct?
I would tend to believe mm-hmm. so.
So how did he make it through prison with his prison breeches on?
I thought you were going for a Ted Hagger joke.
There was actually a lot of snarky things. There was a website up and been trying to raise money for his release from the prison. And quite a few of the ones who posted and signed the petition were obviously trollers. And some of them were commenting about the potential sexual relationships that Hovin was having in the slammer. I'm afraid
he was not a giver. He wasn't a giver. He was definitely selling some body parts for cigarettes.
Sai, do you need me to bring back the music from last week?
No, just everybody let the Eddie Goomba song go through your head. And remember the second revision of that video.
Very music.
Where he was being pursued by an amorous prisoner. Anyway, all right. Here we go. 5 whole minutes. We're kicking ass now. Here we go.
To be accurate. So does Alabama. Textbook shall be adequate and current. Up to date. Okay? The latest information. Texas has a law that says instructional material shall be factual. Go Texas. Okay? Florida has a law that requires accuracy of instructional materials, and the commissioner is responsible to remove books that are not accurate. Well, commissioner,
all right,
do your job. Okay? Watch this video and remove the books that are not accurate. It's too simple.
All right, get to the assertions.
So simple. Okay? Drink. California.
Okay, who called it?
I need it. RJ.
I wanted to say something real quick.
Okay.
Jump in.
As a Texan, I am appalled. I don't sound like that.
You do not.
All right, that's it.
Well, it sounds like Mr. Hogan wants to bring back a good old-fashioned book burning.
You don't sound like this. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
I will point out that in Texas, you have more currently the dentist creationist Nimrod McLeroy. And before that, the I've suddenly lost their names. Anyway, they were a couple who were assailing textbooks, not just science textbooks, but history textbooks that didn't fit their culture camp model. Mm. And they functionally had a veto power over the kind of textbooks that would be in the Texas market. And because the Texas market is so big, functionally it was a veto on the content of any science text and history text that was in any school anywhere in the country. And there's a background information here that relates to the fact that the kind of creationist propaganda, or at least creationist filter, has long been operating in the textbook certification measure for at least the past 20 years.
I think that was Billy Gibbons, Frank Beard, and I don't remember the other guy.
I can't think of the Gablers. Nell and Martha Gabler. Yeah, those were the two who preceded the McLeroy set back in the 1970s and 80s.
All right, here we go. Oh, Andy's heading out. Good night, Andy. Says the pain meds are kicking in.
Well,
see you soon.
A Hovind video. He had to take something.
I would imagine. That's.
I think the accent is, you know, for his preaching, it gains rapport with people. You know, they seem more. I don't know. Honest, maybe.
Maybe could be it. Anyway,
or maybe the Holy Spirit causes Southern drawl. Who knows?
You think he was speaking in tongues? Almost.
I thought Southern drawl was caused by country music and being a wannabe cowboy with a pickup truck and boots, even though you work at a Starbucks in Austin.
Country draw is just because you're just so laid back that you just don't care what goes on around you, and you just want to make sure people understand what you're articulating.
I
grew up in Sacramento, California, right? And we had those fake country people all around with the pickup trucks and the cowboy hats and Wrangler jeans, and they was talking like this: "You're in California."
Maybe they were watching too much Dukes of Hazzard.
Could be.
Jesus Christ.
All right, here we go.
California says textbooks shall be factually accurate.
Oh, come on, we get
and
it.
Reflect,
yes.
Current and confirmed research. Okay. Minnesota says a teacher shall not deliberately suppress or distort subject matter.
Okay.
Through every damn state.
Wait a minute.
Okay.
I have family from Minnesota, right?
Okay.
And what he just did there, that is an Irish accent. That is not a Minnesotan accent. You know, the Minnesota is... Oh, don't you know?
Funny what's on urine, huh?
that would be Canadian.
No. My Aunt Nancy, you know, she's up there, over there in Minnesota. She lives in St. Paul. And they kind of, you know, they're very nice people. And they say, don't you know, a lot.
I'm going to call you out on that. That is Canadian, not Irish.
That is not Canadian.
Are you saying that
Kent, that's Nova Scotian?
Are you saying Kent is doing Canadian?
Yeah. That's Nova Scotian.
Oh.
I can confirm this.
Nova Scotia.
Tao, the only one I actually know is Canadian.
All right. I don't know if he's going to run through every state, but remember what I said about jumping ahead? It's getting
No, this made it worth it. I want to hear the accents now.
All right. Okay. Let's let it go then. We'll see what comes up next.
New York.
Oh, that one's going to rock. I bet it'll be Taxi Cab.
I can't wait till he goes pack the car and have it, yad.
Oh, he's going to Boston.
All right. I just want him to get into his assertions and say what in the book is false, in the textbooks is false, and why. That's what I'm waiting for. But all right, let's
be waiting a while.
I'm going to give you a spoiler. I have not watched this video, but I can guarantee you it's anything that goes against creationism.
That might be it. It is entirely possible.
In fact, let me drop down a prediction here as to what we're likely to be getting. We're going to get a bunch of origins or bust stuff. So I'm assuming he's going to bring up the Miller-Urey experiment. That's a common trope. He may or may not play off of the Cambrian explosion because that was a very common trope.
It's also one of his favorites.
Subjects I'm expecting to see there.
He'll do horse evolution and also Piltdown Man and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that one may very pop up as well. What's ironically going to be kind of hard for him to deal with is dinosaurs, because there's nothing on them from the intelligent design side, and there's very little on it from the creation science side. So he may have a little bit of a trouble to kind of slip that one in, other than just to mention material about radiometric dating issues. But that's kind of the tropes that he beats like a dead horse in his older videos, and we'll see whether or not he's come up with anything new.
If he ever gets done with the states, yeah. All right, here we go.
About 40 states to go through.
All right.
Find out what Delaware says.
He's going to hit the territories, too. All right, here we go.
The problem is none of those states enforce their own laws. I don't know if Tennessee here has a law that requires textbook accuracy. They ought to if they don't have one. If you don't have one, pass one. This is a textbook from about 100 years ago. It says, God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Prayer is a duty, but it's vain to pray without a sincere desire of heart. God governs the world in infinite wisdom. You believe that's a public school textbook?
Sounds like straight physics to me.
Well, here's one today. Evolution is fact, not theory. Birds arose from non-birds and humans from non-humans. No person who pretends to any understanding of the natural world can deny these facts. Wow, something's changed.
Okay.
I just watched this section, and the thing that pops in my mind is, remember how we've kind of fixed things in this country and moved forward, and now these people want to take us backwards?
Yeah.
Isn't that just great?
That's a lovely thing.
It's just fantastic. And this one little textbook, they like to use this one a lot. This specific quote from this specific textbook, I see it all the time. They used it in they've used it in Christian movies and all over the place. It's just fantastic.
Indeed.
Well, and you notice how many know any who Richard Lawton is?
Oh, the name sounds familiar.
But there's a reason why they focus on Lawton, because he is a Marxist.
Oh,
this
God.
Fits in with their political perspective. So he is just the positive darling of authority quotes to bring up as a representative of the atheist, Marxist, leftist perspective. And he sort of joined with the hip with Stephen Jay Gould and others. Lawton, after all, and Gould were the ones that came up with the spandrels concept and a few other things. He's a very respected geneticist, but he does have a political axe to grind. So there's no coincidence that his name keeps on popping up. On the 1908 textbook, that one, I'd love to know what school districts used it. Just because a textbook existed in 1908 doesn't mean that it was one that was reflecting of the science of the time. Because if you were to have gone through and looked at any of the curricula in any of the colleges and university level science, it was knee deep in evolution by 1908. So this 1908 textbook that he uses is way behind the curve, and I will wager a dollar to a hole in a donut it may have been in a public school that was in a highly religious state and favored.
I'd like to point something out. Sly, you got the Sidestrike, you got the actual full size video there going on.
Do in fact.
What is the name of that book? Or supposedly the name of the book?
That is, now we have no guarantee that that is the copyright 2000 textbook reference, but that is Discover Biology.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out why something is copyrighted as 2000 textbook. I've never heard of a book titled that.
I have not.
Well, you have various. In terms of the copyright thing, typically the textbooks that are produced are generated over an enormous period of time, and textbooks are always dumbed down. They're awkward. They have to be rammed through textbook revision committees. To revise them very often because it's very expensive for them to do that kind of stuff. So the material is as rudimentary and as generalized as they can get. Now, where 1981 Richard Lawton quote is coming in this 2000 textbook, which would mean that if it is in that textbook at all, it's almost 20 years old at the time the textbook was being done. It's a perfectly fine authority quote summary of evolutionary view. Birds indeed arose from non-birds, but simply tossing it off as an authority figure is quite irrelevant. He is going to be objecting, Kent Hovind is going to be objecting to all of the stuff that doesn't fit his dogma. But the kind of he's using are going to be things he did not himself uncover. He is troping material he's gotten from other people's apologetics. So we're already seeing somebody that's several steps removed from the primary sources.
What we have going on here is Mr. PhD Kent Hovind not understanding how citations are done when he makes his PowerPoint presentation.
Yeah, I'm guessing APA standards was not a big thing at his little garage where he studied and got his PhD. Mm-hmm. Was it a barn? I'm sorry, it was a barn.
A barn. Very, very barnish.
Putting in the dates at all, because that's often not put in. When you look at quote mines in the creationism literature, and intelligent design literature too, you would be just as likely to see the Lawton quote with no date attached and no book to give you any idea where it was coming from. Like it's just popping out of the middle of nowhere. So in a weird kind of a way, Kent is actually being fairly scrupulous for creationist apologetics in putting up a kind of half-assed technical material.
Pretending he put up a citation. Yeah, it's good.
Indeed.
Yeah.
All right. And we have something to look into. We have to see if there's an author named textbook, and if this book, which we have a picture of, if it actually is this book that he's referring to. All right, let's move on here and hear some of the lies.
Changed. Actually, I was at Chickasaw, Oklahoma, a couple of weeks ago. It was supposed to be a debate, but none of the professors would debate me, so they scheduled an evolution seminar 2 days after I was gone. They let me come speak on creation, the student.
Okay.
RJ here. I should point out that there is a good reason why people wanted to avoid Kent Hovind. And that is because this guy, as you've already seen, has got a good gift to gab, and he is a positive dervish when it comes to flailing away and making bald assertions. There are few people in the entire anti-evolution literature who can spew out more misinformation faster than Kent Hovind can when he's up to speed. And unless you are walking around with an ability to fact check things on the fly, which you couldn't do in those days, you can do it a lot faster now. This is a guy who's very formidable. He's had debates with other creationists, old earth creationists and others. He's never debated intelligent designers because they don't go after that kind of stuff. But he's actually very good at the purpose that he's doing these things, which is to have an evangelical debate with somebody who he moves faster than. It's also the case downstream who want to arrange these debates, creationist friendly kids and all that, are happy to have him on the scene, and he'll come in and do his little lectures no matter what. So I average scientist, they may or may not have been even aware of what he is, and they're coming at it very dry and didactic, and they're trying to deal with this Tasmanian devil rape guy. It's not easy for them to do that.
Okay, I've just been doing some searching on this whole copyright thing for textbooks.
Yes.
It does say copyright and then the year and then the company who owns the copyright, not just textbook.
Yep.
Just saying.
Okay. Duly noted. All right. Shall we move on?
Group got me in there. Here's a poster they put up right next to my poster. The poster was inviting people to come to the evolution seminar. Interested in evolution? Well, come on down. Evolution lecture with Dr. Mather and Dr. Ray. It says, hear both sides of the issue. Well, we invited them to debate. They could have heard both sides all together. Here the kids get 9 months of evolution teaching. I come in for 2 hours and they panic. And then they got to say, hear both sides. Both sides? You're not going to present both sides.
But, okay, this is not a drink moment, but it is kind of odd that Kent thinks that he's automatically the other side. That there's the standardized theory of evolution.
He is the only.
Yeah, but that automatic assumption, there's the theory of evolution, and then there's me. And those are the two sides. Again, not a drink
and
moment, but sort of telling.
Of the correct version of creationism, and no others need apply, although he may refer to great creation scientists. By and large, Hovind rarely references anybody else in the creationism field other than himself. He may allude to their findings, but he doesn't usually attribute much to them. He doesn't mention them by name. He doesn't schmooze very much. Most of the regular creationists regard Hovind as an nincompoop, and this is creationist thinking this. So the ones that have the real live PhDs, Andrew Snelling and that crowd, look down their nose on him as a bumpkin. So he's running in a very different setting where he's going at the grassroots. He's not operating at the level of the kind of academics that you would be bumping into at the college level.
Indeed. All right. Here we go.
You're going to present one side. The evolution side, which is what they already got for 9 months. They don't want to hear it. I think they said 20 people turned up, 15 of them are from the Baptist Student Union, just to see what the teachers would say. Okay. They hear both sides. Their own textbook there in Chickasaw, Oklahoma, has one quarter of the book, one entire unit devoted only to evolution teaching. Nothing about creation. Evolution's a dying religion surviving only on tax dollars. It's dead.
Drink.
This textbook has...
It's a religion reference, isn't it? Go ahead.
Well, actually not.
Oh, okay.
It's the references evolution is a dying... RJ here. Yep. That evolution is a dying theory. Oh, that is so hilariously not true. That if you actually look at the people who do paleontology, genetics, developmental biology, zoology, you can just go discipline after discipline after discipline, and I track tens of thousands of them in my hashtag tip work, that just... part and parcel of their whole worldview in here. So the idea that the people who are doing the work somehow or other are the dying breed, and Kent Hovind, who has never got within 1,000 miles of digging up anything or doing a gene analysis or any other such thing, is a reflection of the true science, is just hilarious and an insult to all the people who actually do the work.
You guys, yes, the CBO looked into evolution and found that it's not collapsing, right? It's not collapsing.
Well, just to point out, this video was made before he did his prison stint. So he's been, you know, hindsight's 2020, and we can see that he was obviously wrong because evolution's been growing. But, you know, he's in prison and missed all that.
Well, no, this, yeah, as though this was true even before that. The thing is listening to him will. No clue about how little information he actually has correct. very few of them actually bother to read science. I've been tracking this again. 95% of all the different 2000 anti-evolutionists that I track never bother citing primary material. They just copy somebody else's argument. Kent Hovind falls within that same frame. So it's a trope too. You get in over on the intelligent design side. They're under the impression that because they can gather together 1,000 of their little cadre that are skeptical of Darwin and they have PhD degrees, that therefore that is showing that evolution is on its last legs and it's going to fizzle out. But some people over the years have actually tracked the various evolution is at death's door group as they see the same quotes coming up in the 1880s and the 1900s and the 1920s and the 1940s and the 1960s, that evolution is about ready to disappear. It's on its way out. No one's paying attention to it anymore. Meanwhile, the scientists just keep on moving on. They apparently didn't get the memo.
Indeed. And and also it's tied way too closely with Charles Darwin and Darwinism. Things have advanced.
Yeah,
quite a bit since then.
I'm going to apologize for my previous joke that was trying to make a reference to Obamacare. It was very bad. It was very bad.
You sound like Trump saying that. Your voice.
Everybody knows. We all know. Obamacare is going to collapse.
You know it, and I know it. Yeah.
You know it, I know it. It's sad. It's sad.
Gonna crash.
You got to show us your hands, man.
Yeah, it's terrible. It's terrible.
See, I feel like I sound hands.
Like Bernie. All right, oh, here, small hands, tiny hands. When you do Trump, you just have to play the accordion. That's what you do. You're just playing the accordion.
Yes.
All right, let's.
And I would wager, just as a.
Have you seen that video?
Oh yeah.
A further bit. The audience for Kent Hovind are very likely to have voted for Donald Trump, and they will be Donald Trump supporters currently.
Yep.
That's probably the case. All right, here we go.
There's over 100 pages where evolution is talked about. There's not one single mention of creation. So don't tell me they want to hear both sides. They don't, okay? They want to present one view only. It's called indoctrination, not education. Now, this is a chart showing how the atheists feel.
Okay, so we're not going to call drink on just irony, right? Right. We'll let that kind of.
I can call a drink on one thing. Is that he's just pulled RJ here? He's just pulled a fast one, because when he says there's no references to creation, evolution isn't about the creation of life per se, and it's not about religion concepts. You have theistic evolutionists and all the rest. In the same sense that a book on geography mentioned the creation view that the world is flat. It's not an alternative. It's only going to be talking about the science data. And because the science data doesn't fit his version of science data, it's going to be talking about millions of years. It's going to be talking about speciation events and all of that. His version of creation is never going to be in the science text. No religion discussion at all is in the science text. It's talking about the data in the same way that a geography book is going to talk about Indiana not being next to California on a spherical Earth.
Now, you see, he's just slippery like a snake. He's just throwing out the arguments left and right and just taking it through the weeds.
And we have some weed there on his table in the back there. There's around there. There's some greenery on there. I think we can maybe find Satan's snake slithering out at some point during the presentation.
We shall see. All right. And moving on.
Feel that the different states are doing with the teaching of evolution. They think you folks in Tennessee are doing a lousy job of teaching evolution to your kids. Go Tennessee. All right. Hey, hey.
During my formative years, I lived in Tennessee, and they taught evolution very well. Thank you very much.
Okay, then.
I would like to point out that he is applauding poor education.
Well, you know, schooling is the devil.
Now, don't you make fun of my education.
How dare you think for yourself?
All right, here we go. Oh, and guys, when you call drink or when you're going to speak, try and announce yourself so people know who to respond to if they need to. Here we go.
They think the folks right over here in North Carolina are doing a good job of teaching evolution. Well, North Carolina folks, get on the ball. Turn your state red by the next time they do this survey, okay? Now, is there anybody here that thinks teachers or textbooks should be allowed to use outdated or false information just to get students to believe a theory? Would that be a good idea?
No, we agree on that one.
Okay.
I would agree. Okay.
Anybody here that thinks teachers that deliberately lie should be fired? Okay. Is there anybody here that thinks textbooks with lies should be banned or the lies torn out of the book? Think that'd be fair? All right. Well, buckle up. Hang on. Let's go. It's always amazed me how two people can look at the same thing and come to opposite conclusions of what they are looking at. You know, two people can look at Grand Canyon. One of them believes in evolution. He looks at the canyon and says, wow, look what the Colorado River did.
Great.
For millions.
Okay.
Greg.
Okay, Sean, you're up.
What the hell does geography have to do with evolution?
Oh, everything to these people.
Haven't you heard Eric? Everything. First off, talking about evolution. He may even say it during this. First, you got to clarify what you're talking about. There's stellar evolution. And he goes through a litany of seven different kinds, six. Mm-hmm.
Plus, they're young.
It's all part of a pack.
You know better.
Has anybody ever noticed how these creationists like to confuse theory with hypothesis?
They do.
They know the definition of theory.
I've never seen that
before. That's kind of farther down the road. In fact, you tend to get that evolution is only a theory modality from the young Earth creationist camp. It's a trope that doesn't show up much in intelligent design bit. And indeed, the top level creationists say, don't use that argument. It's a bad one. But remember, people like Kent Hovind are way downstream. They're not even bothering to read their modern creationism stuff. But remember, billions and millions of years are not allowed in his version of creationism in principle. That's way more important than, say, trilobite skulls.
Well, he couldn't keep up to date on it because they don't give him those kind of textbooks in prison.
Well, no, but remember, that tiny amount of time he spent in prison, that's not part of his formative years. No, he didn't have to worry.
I just
believe you me, he is not going to try. He could actually get online. He would be able to access all of the technical literature if he felt like it online, I'm sure, because he was tweeting stuff and communicating constantly with people while he was in prison. So he had access to communications on there.
Well, I just imagine he didn't have access to his money. His son had it all.
Yeah. And RJ, about this not being part of his formative years while he was in prison, I would venture to say he probably learned a few new things.
Yeah, he learned a few new tricks in prison.
I just imagine Kent in prison is like the daughter in Grey Gardens, the old documentary, where she's got she's always got weird clothes on, she's dancing around, she's arguing with her mother all the time. Kent and his cellmate has to be a sitcom in the making that I really want to see.
Huh. We'll see if we can get that footage.
That'll cost you $9.95 a minute.
I can tell you the last thing I ever want to see is Kent Hovind in anything other than a full dress suit, because this is not once you see it, you can never unsee it.
He is not a pretty man.
Just think two girls, one cup.
We're not gonna ask how you know that. Okay, here we go.
And millions of years. The Bible-believing Christian stands there, looks at the same canyon, and says, wow, look what the flood did in about 30 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
How was that canyon formed, huh? Textbook says over millions of years, the Colorado River carved the Grand Canyon from solid rock. Oh, now, hold on a second, okay? It's a fact Grand Canyon exists. I've been there a bunch of times, studied. I taught earth science for 15 years. I love studying Grand Canyon. There are two interpretations of how it got there. The evolutionists will say it formed slowly.
Drink.
Okay, Kevin, you're up.
Okay, a high school science teacher is not studying anything. A high school science teacher is literally what they criticize, just teaching out of a book. A high school science teacher is not publishing papers. A high school science teacher is showing up every day, bitching about his job, complaining about the kids, going home and drinking himself to sleep.
And remember, Kent Hovind's version of a high school science teacher was teaching in a Christian school where all he's doing is repeating the stuff that he's gotten from 1960s and 1970s creationism literature. And I can guarantee you that dear old Kent is never going to have been fact-checking any of the material he copies.
Good chance of that. All right. let's see the comparison here. The evolutionist view of the, although, okay, I could see where evolution is involved. We do see time and his fossils, and all right, maybe there's some evolution involved. Here we go.
Well, yeah, if in their minds, if they can prove that the Earth is as young as they say it is, 6,000 years, then evolution didn't have time to occur.
Indeed.
Except for the kinds that came off the Ark. Those
hypercharged. Absolutely hypercharged evolution then.
Yes, yes. Boy, frisky, frisky.
Careful, that was starting to sound like daytime, nighttime.
Yeah, I had the music queued up. Nighttime. I'm waiting for the moment.
1,200 species of finch in only a few thousand years.
Indeed. Happy little finches, I guess. Here we go.
Water in lots of time, like, you know, billions of years. The creationists will say, no, it formed quickly by lots of water and a little bit of time, like a big flood in the days of Noah. And the guys who believe in evolution are...
Okay.
RJ here, if I may put in a plug for the impending video that you are editing up, we have addressed all of these points in great detail. The creationist is requiring the canyon rock and the canyon itself to be formed virtually simultaneously. How does it get to be rock that's hard enough for the water to come along and then carve the canyon in it? You can't have both of them happening all at the same time. And apparently on all of his many visits to the canyon, Dr. Hovind never managed to spot that rather obvious problem with the creationist interpretation.
Indeed. And yes, RJ is right. That multi-part video rebuttal to Is Genesis History will be coming out shortly and does address this very topic in great detail. And,
with a special introduction by Ken Ham.
Indeed. Ken Ham's in on it. And I wish Paul Agia was here. That's T and I.
Where's what?
Paul Agia. Where is he?
I'm here.
Oh, Jesus. I didn't. Nice. Oh, I don't see you. You don't show up in the thing here. There you are. All right.
Yeah, it's Tau City Alpha and three more. The stupid little window on the right hand side isn't enough to include all of the little mugs.
Indeed, I'm not loving this commercial version of Hangouts. It has some benefits, but I'm just we may go back to the old way. In any case, moving on with the canyon. Let's see how much more foolishness we get.
Always trying to erase the line between their interpretation and try to include it as if it is part of the fact. No, it's just your interpretation, guys, okay? This textbook says, the Colorado River has cut through layer upon layer of rock over millions of years. Well, now, hold on a minute. This textbook says, the Colorado River cut through 2,000 meters of rock, exposing sediment layers like huge pages in the Book of Life. Scan the canyon wall from rim to floor, and you look back through hundreds of millions of years. I don't think so. I was in a debate one time, and this atheist said, Hovind, you're so stupid. Don't you know it took millions of years to carve the Grand Canyon? I said, well, sir, there's a couple things you ought to learn about Grand Canyon. If you built a dam across Grand Canyon, a huge lake would fill in behind it, covering several states, okay? I mean, take a lot of dirt to build a dam, but if you could build a dam across that...
across the Grand Canyon. They did! I'm not the only one, right? They did do this.
That's the Glen Canyon Dam.
I don't know what to say right now because they did.
Or maybe the Hoover Dam. I'm not sure which.
All right. Here we go. It's the lake thing again.
Canyon, you'd have a really big lake. Actually, some of the water from Wyoming drains through the Grand Canyon. It has a huge drainage pattern. There's a picture of it, satellite false color image. You can see Grand Canyon right there, a big gash right across a ridge in the mountains. You folks in Tennessee know what a ridge is. Not really a mountain, just a big long ridge, okay? I've flown by and taken lots of pictures. I asked the pilot one time, I said, man, are we going near Grand Canyon? He said, yeah, about 100 miles. I said, can you get permission to, you know, divert and go closer? He said, let me see what I can do. He got permission, and we flew right over the top of the canyon. I'm taking pictures like crazy, you know. Love studying Grand Canyon. Actually, it's a bunch of useless real estate. I mean, what would you do with it if you had it, you know? You can look at it and then go home. That's about it. But, I mean, you can't plow it, that's for sure, and you don't want your cows playing out there. But I said to this professor, I said, sir, there's a couple things to consider about this canyon. I said, these two red lines indicate what's called the snow line, okay? Between those two red lines is a ridge that gets about 6,900 to 8,500 feet above sea level. Now, the river enters the canyon at the far right over there at 2,800-foot elevation. The river flows downhill for 270 miles. Comes out the other side. If you look at it from a side view, a schematic view, it'll look like this. The river comes in, 2,800-foot elevation. The ground rises up while the river goes down for 270 miles. I said, now, sir, there's a few things you ought to consider about this canyon. I said, did you know the top of Grand Canyon is higher than the bottom? He said, obviously. I said, sir, did you know the river only runs through the bottom? He said, well, yeah. I said, sir, did you know the top is higher than where the river enters the canyon by over 4,000 feet?
Does Kent not know what erosion is?
Apparently
here,
not.
Here, of course, he has a teeny tiny little problem that we can measure the movements and uplifts of land masses, and they change the way rivers come through. It doesn't matter whether or not the age of the Earth is great or not. The creation model cannot explain the exact shape of the canyon. No matter how fast the water is, it cannot produce the canyon that exists. We know this, and ironically, as we'll be talking about in that little video thing, Steve Austin, in effect, acknowledges the fact that the kind of water levels involved can't explain the data that you can actually find in the canyon. It would be way too big. They're caught on a level of stupidity. The problem is that Kent is removed even from that technical discussion. He's no Andrew Snelling. He's not a creationist geologist. He's a doofus who is copying other people's arguments secondarily.
I don't know that I could prove this in the court of law, but I have a slight feeling that this conversation is apocryphal. It may not have happened.
He loves airplane conversations. When I was talking to him on the phone, this was like 20 years ago, his dime, fortunately, he was recounting a conversation, and he inevitably encounters scientists on airplanes or conversations that he has with people just on the fly. And he has these wonderful little folksy chats where he tells the truth of creation to them. They may have elements of truth in the same way the Gospel of Paul has tiny little elements of truth buried in it somewhere, maybe kind of, sort of. But boy, trying to ferret out in that brain of his what actually happened in any of those conversations, no, that's not easily worked out.
Indeed. And another reason why we're using why we're watching Kent tonight is this argument, which was, I mean, so handily refuted just now. You know, the whole top of the canyon being, you know, higher than where the river enters. That very same argument was made in a Creation Minute by his son Eric just last year. So
that was fancy graphics.
Nothing. Yes. Actually, nothing has changed.
Actually, the north rim of the canyon. The north rim of the Grand Canyon is several thousand feet higher than the south rim of the Grand Canyon. The whole thing slopes downhill, but it's not important to know where the is now after 60 million years. It's what it looked like when the original water started to trickle through it in the beginning formation of the canyon. And that kind of put all the pieces together, jigsaw puzzle working over time thing, is one that if you try to look at the detailed stratigraphy, what you actually see layer by layer, moment by moment, get within 100 miles of explaining any of that data. And I know because I see what the professional creationists do, Andrew Snelling and all the bunch, Steve Austin and that crowd, they actually have PhDs in geology, and they steer clear of the data. Poor little Hovind is way too downstream, paddling as fast as he can.
Indeed. All right. Hopefully he'll get out of the canyon soon.
Dazed look on his face like a calf looking at a new gate. I said, sir, did you know rivers don't flow uphill in Tennessee? There's no delta. Where's the mud that washed out of Grand Canyon? Nobody has a clue, okay? That river did not make that canyon. Grand Canyon's a washed out spillway. There used to be two big lakes, Grand Lake and
Hope. Oh, drink.
Okay. All right. RJ, you're up.
Yes, actually, they have found masses of the sediment that has come downstream and is out down in the Gulf of Mexico and various other parts. And because there's been a lot of plate tectonics movements, there are, after all, a great amount of seismic activity going along in there, as people in California tend to discover every once in a while because the land moves. It's a hard thing to find, not quite as complicated to find as San Francisco or the Puget Sound area, but still a difficult little puzzle to go with. And I know by direct observation, Hovind has never bothered to look at any of that technical science literature, even though it exists and existed when he was given this spiel in 2005.
Yeah, but you know, that's just evidence. That doesn't really matter, right?
It doesn't.
Certainly not. We'll have none of that. Evidence is the devil. Here we go.
Happy Lake. The lakes are long gone, but the beaches are still there. You can still see the beach line. They got too full and went over the top and washed out that canyon in a hurry. Any farmer that's ever built a dam to hold water for his cows will tell you, once the water goes over the top of the dam, it's all over with. That's why they guard the levee like crazy during flood seasons, don't they? Get out there with sandbags. You don't want it to even get started. It's gone in a flash, okay? This river flows down this way. Obviously, it started at the top. Must have been a big lake backed up there, too. Even El Paso, Texas is called El Paso because it's the pass, okay? I bet there used to be a big lake backed up behind El Paso that dried up and left the white sands of New Mexico behind. That's another long, interesting story. But if you look at Grand Canyon, it's pretty obvious it's a washed-out spillway, okay? Almost all rivers around the world...
Okay. Is that it? Just know it isn't. You good with that?
Yeah, the most we'll see whether he brings it up. I suspect he may very well bring up the infamous Columbia Lake Missoula Spokane floods. The problem is that I live up in this area and I know how different floods, which actually are formed from rapid flood water, is from the Grand Canyon. The Grand Canyon has sections of vertical walls, but it's also a series of nested V-shaped valleys, and it that kind of incised format only occurs in rivers that are cutting down through geology that's caused when there is a change in the distance from the top to the bottom of the waterhead. And you found exactly the same thing happening with the Nile River. Other rivers don't do that. In fact, the interesting thing about it is how rare such canyons are. There was a guy named Playfair who was a geologist back in the early 1800s, and he pointed out how it's odd that there are so few waterfalls around. And that's because rivers are so old that they basically don't allow waterfalls. You have to have relatively recent tectonic changes to divert rivers to produce that kind of a thing. And the kinds of deep canyons that we see occasionally on the earth are very, very rare. And it happens to be because of an unusual set of circumstances with the continental uplift. There's still a certain amount of debate as to how much of the pieces of the canyon we see now are reflective of a way earlier canyon that's gotten basically submerged because different drainage patterns were occurring and other things were in it. So it's a colossal jigsaw puzzle over an amount, huge amount of time. But again, none of that material is going to be filtering into Kent Hovind, who's filtering his material from 20, 30-year-old creationist literature.
He also seems to skip over the whole meandering path thing that fast-moving spillway water wouldn't really create. But anyone who's ever been there or seen pictures, fast-moving water would not have done that.
And it still doesn't explain how it came to be rock. Although most of the canyon is Precambrian, in the upper levels you start hitting the Cambrian deposits, and the Coconino and a lot of these other places are Cambrian and Ordovician, and then you move up the upper end of the south end of the canyon is pretty much a Cretaceous era. Or earlier than that, and then you find you're starting to get Jurassic deposits and that are even younger, that's farther upstream. And when you move into northern Utah, and I've visited around in there, Bryce Canyon and all that stuff, when you're upstream, up above the Grand Canyon, you're in a much younger period of rocks, and it's very characteristic by what fossils are in them. In order for those things to have been laid down in the flood, and remember the creationists like Hovind require they were laid down in the flood, how did they get turned into rock fast enough for the canyon to be carved by another flood that comes along later when the supposed dam breaks?
RJ, I have to call you on this one. Mr. Hovind has already explained that, in that he said it all occurred in 30 minutes. So that's 15 minutes for the flood sediment to turn into rock, and then another 15 minutes for the cutting. He already explained that.
And he does it by idiot.
It's like kind of like the floating rocks in Pandora. You know, it's using that unobtainium stuff.
All right, here we go. Holy crap. It's 11 minutes after 1, and we've gone 13 and a half minutes into this. I'm not sure how this is going to go.
You chose it, not us.
It seemed appropriate. We spent time on Eric, and I know this is going to be precursors to everything Eric says. I thought it would be interesting, and... All right, my apologies to everybody. My apologies to everybody. Here we go.
I'm sorry. I just can't do it. I'm going to go. It's way too late.
Not
13 minutes in. I can't do it.
I appreciate you coming at all, Chief. Not to worry. Good having you.
But Save yourself.
If I had a choice, I would run from listening to Kent or Eric. I would.
It's not too late. You can leave too.
See, okay.
You don't have to stay here.
Slice Strike, this is why I normally avoid Hovind stuff, is because either one of them, because there's just so much stupid you cannot possibly get through their video in a decent amount of time.
Agreed. And I did have some other stuff queued up if we blew through it.
Ursa Ed has got a great comment. 15 minutes to turn into rock. God had a spontaneous hard on in Nevada.
Is it time for my music? Is it time for my music?
Go ahead.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, baby. Let me tell you about a little thing called the Grand Canyon. Way back in time, now I'm talking about 6000 BC, there was a groovy cat named God. Now, he was just cruising around the western United States one time. He saw himself this sexy lady. And he started to get a feeling down below the waistline. And you don't want to know what happened once you started getting that feeling. Oh, yeah.
Geese and feldspar!
He jumped right on into that canyon, I'm going to tell you right now.
This is not scientific refutation, guys.
No.
Nicely
Grand
done,
Canyon
Kevin.
Would be a terrible stripper name.
Nicely done, Kevin.
Oh, I don't know. That might be a great canyon. Yeah, Grand Canyon.
All right. Don't
talk bad about my stepdaughter.
Hey, somebody with a name like Grand Canyon is definitely hot dog down a hallway situation.
Well, let's see where Keith goes next.
All right. Here we go.
That'll make for a lot of awkward family reunions, too.
All right.
Come together at what's called acute angles, less than 90 degrees. I mean, the rivers merge and keep going the same, you know, general direction. If you look at Grand Canyon, the rivers on the lower left are indeed merging at acute angles, less than 90 degrees. But if you look at the upper right, the rivers are flowing backwards. Why would they do that? The rivers run backwards, hit the main channel, turn around, and come back out the other way. It's called a barbed canyon. There aren't many places like this on the planet. Well, this is evidence that a lake is draining, and as the water's running off the spillway backwards into the channel, it turns around, or off the dam, water runs off the dam into the low place, turns around, and comes back out through the crack, through the breach in the dam. Grand Canyon was not made by the Colorado River over millions of years. That is one of the lies you kids are going to face in your textbook. It's just not geophysically possible for that to happen. Now, are there any farmers or vets in the crowd that might know what this machine is? What is that, brother? That's a calf puller.
A calf puller?
That's a what? A calf puller.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Once in a while, a cow has a hard time having that baby calf, and so to get the calf puller out, tie the cable around the calf's legs and
stop giggling.
Jack the calf out of the cow. You get a few tons of pressure on there, calf comes right out, no problem. Well, one day, this farmer was out pulling a calf. It was a breech birth, the back feet are coming out first. That's not good, but you know, it happens once in a while. So the farmer had the calf puller out there, and he's trying to pull the calf out of the cow. And a city fella stopped his car to see what on earth is going on.
Oh, all city fella.
And the farmer said, have you ever seen anything like this before? The city fella said, I have never seen nothing like this. The farmer said, do you have any questions? The city fella said, yes, sir. I have one question. It's been bugging me for 10 minutes. The farmer said, well, what's your question? And the city fella said, how fast do you figure that calf was going when it ran into that cow?
Oh, my God.
No, 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 no. We're not separating the wreck here, fellas. You know, it's possible for two people to be looking at the same thing, and one of them is getting the wrong idea of what he's looking at.
Okay, have we established that Sean was correct, that Kent may have been a grievous error?
Yes.
I think so. All right, well, at least this is a segue. He may be moving on to another assertion now. Maybe we can clear up at least two of his wacky assertions without...
But it's your show if you want to move on to something else.
Well, what else we got? Let's see. Well, we've got that short dinosaur hoax one you brought up earlier, I think.
That's a good palate cleanser at some point.
Yeah, I was going to wrap up with that. The people, the team always loves that. And we also have, you know what? I was trying to keep it all in the Hovind vein. We've got more battleship apologetics. Are science and religion compatible? So what do you think?
Oh, man.
Let this...
Well, I think if we're going to... I think we can keep our Hovind time to this Hovind.
Okay.
That'd be my vote. But, you know, we can take a break, an intermission with the other one if you want.
All right. We could, I guess. All right. Why don't we see if he gets to another assertion, then maybe we'll jump over and do that.
Since the people were asking in the chat, yeah, that was me with the porno music.
There was doubt? There was... All right, let's do a little more of Dad Hovind, and then maybe we'll move on. There we go.
The Bible warned us that was going to happen. Knowing this first, there shall come in the last days...
Okay, no.
Scoffers.
Jumping ahead.
The things are happening now is the way they've always been happening. Long, slow, gradual processes. Bible says the scoffers are willingly ignorant. Willingly ignorant. In the Greek, that means dumb on purpose. Mm-hmm. They're willingly ignorant of how God made the heavens and the earth.
Okay.
Ignorant does not mean dumb. Ignorant just means you lack knowledge on a topic. That can be cured. Dumb cannot.
This is
dumb
true.
Dumb means you cannot speak. Hate to say it, Hovind, you need to pick up a freaking dictionary.
Didn't we have that same problem with ham?
I mean, seriously, dumb literally means unable to speak.
Indeed.
Helen Keller was deaf, dumb, and blind.
Mm-hmm.
She couldn't see, she couldn't hear, and she couldn't speak.
Unrelated to ignorance. I agree.
It's unrelated to ignorance. Yes.
Alrighty. Here we go.
Earth, and they're ignorant of the flood. The world was overflowed with water and perished. We cover more on that on videotape number two of our series. But
enough
one of the scoffers in the last days was a guy named James Hutton.
Button?
Now, James Hutton lived in the late 1700s. James wrote a book and said the earth is millions of years old. Now, you need to understand, in the late 1700s, most people believed the Bible, or at least they were strongly influenced by Christianity. And everybody thought the earth was about 6,000 years old. That was the common teaching of the day. Okay? They taught the kids in the public school, you know, God created the world in 6 days, like we saw earlier. But this was also a time of many revolutions. We had the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the Polish, the Spanish, the German. Every country is just about revolting against the idea of a king and establishing a democracy. So they threw off monarchy, and this is known as the age of anti-monarchy. So the Bible says to honor the king, and some people thought the Bible was an obstacle to their political objectives. And they wanted to discredit the Bible. Keep in mind, this all happened.
Okay.
Historically, the Bible didn't even mention a king being honored at all until King James rewrote it.
Well, and the other fact of the matter is that he's brought up Hutton. Half of what he said is true, that it was during a period of a lot of revolutions and concerned about monarchies because the monarchs were a bunch of nincompoops and it was really good to get rid of some of them. But The problem with bringing up Hutton is Hovind has not mentioned the fact that Hutton offered science evidence for the age of the Earth, most specifically Sicker Point, which was a spectacular piece of geology up in Hutton's neck of the woods that was inconceivable to explain in only a 6,000-year time frame. And the fact of the matter is that the creationists that Kent Hovind is siphoning like a vacuum don't discuss that material very, very much. And he's probably not going to be bringing it up here because he probably doesn't know any of that stuff.
I would also like to point out that no one calls that time period the age of anti-monarchism.
Remember, Kent Hovind, you know how, if you've ever heard Kent Hovind describe the ACLU, he describes it as the American Communist Lawyers Union.
American sure he doesn't throw a Jew reference in there somehow?
Yeah, well, sometimes he'll even get the acronym wrong. He'll put the wrong letters up on there. So he's got an eye-twitching, hyper-conservative. He makes John Birchers sound like they're liberals. If you actually read the politics of Kent Hovind, he's a wackaloon in this respect and comes from that dominionist framework that's on the hyper fringe of conservatism. But we're a long way from poor old Hutton and Sicker Point, S-I-C-C-A-R. I got a video up onto it in my YouTube if you want to look at it. Anyway, let's hear what Schmuck has to say about Hutton.
All right. I'm just surprised he hasn't brought up Jews papers yet.
He has in his dissertation, I think he dangled a little bit about the protocols of the elders of Zion. So he's got some of the anti-Semitism in his background. So
it is in there. All right.
Yeah. He's a creepy little dude underneath the tie.
I'm just going to call him prison bitch.
Okay.
Don't make me turn the music back on.
No, no, not needed. Not needed at this moment, but. Yeah, okay, we'll let it go, but he is, I will just say, Mr. Hovind is not long for my screen. Here we go.
Early 1800s and late 1700s. So back when everybody thought the Earth was a few thousand years old, James Hutton came along and said, oh no, it's lots older than that. And it got here by uniformitarianism. Ooh, kids, big word, bold print. That'll be on the test. They always are, okay? Uniformitarianism means the present is the key to the past.
James.
Okay.
I'll just point out that in that little excerpt, which, by the way, was not a discussion of science data, it was an authority quote, presumably drawn from a textbook that's part of the creationist authority quote line. There was a reference down there to John Playfair, one of Hutton's followers. And remember, I mentioned Playfair was this guy who was actually noticing what was happening with real rivers in real context and real geology. And so is Hutton. So all we're getting here is an authority quote version of the world, as though the people who developed modern geology weren't paying attention to the science data, which they were.
Indeed. He does sort of imply that they just pulled it out of some region of their bodies.
Like the pulled calf.
Like the pulled calf, indeed. Well put. Okay, here we go.
I think the Bible's the only perfect key to the past.
Of course it is.
But there, during this time frame, the Christians, instead of fighting against this new teaching of millions of years, they swallowed it. The Christians accepted the idea of a gap theory, or day-age theory, or progressive creation. They just accepted millions of years right into the Bible, when it's obvious to anybody with half a brain and one eye reading the Bible that it does not teach the earth is millions of years old. That's not what it says. So, the Christians did not put up an effective defense, an effective resistance to this teaching. And they allowed the church to believe all this. And then when evolution came out, 1859 became popular with Darwin's book. Well, the Christians just accepted that, too.
No, they didn't.
Boy, what a tragedy.
They fought against
among evangelicals and others in the 19th century, the acceptance of Darwin was surprisingly fast. You had a certain amount of resistance down in the grassroots area, but most of the major theologians didn't really have a problem with it. And of course, the scientific community adopted Darwinism really rapidly, unless you have particular cultures that had a hold over. The French were always balky about it because of their love of Lamarckianism. And there was also the French clerical bunch The main reason that the British were forefront runners in this area with Darwin and Wallace is they were pioneering a new form of science that was observational based and was also going out in the real world. They were field students that would actually go out and look at the critters living, not having them stuffed and brought back to some museum the way you tended in the French context. But yeah, the amount of concern about how many religious people were balking at evolution at the time in the 19th century, it's actually not as much as you might think.
Yeah, I just remember Darwin got a bad rap, and you know, it wasn't really widely accepted until after he was dead.
No, in the science, really, it was
in science. It was by the moment, but as far as the religious community, he was mocked and ridiculed. You know, he never got to see his works get widespread until you know he was dead. It was actually
In the general scientific community, for one thing, there were an awful lot of evangelicals and who were very much science groupies of the period. There was a long-standing tradition in the Romantic movement of being science groupies. And so it was independent of whether you were on the American side of the Atlantic or the English or French or others. And the school area was starting to develop. Huxley was pioneering the idea of science departments in colleges, and that spread the word on it. But as someone pointed out, by the 1890s, you would have been very hard-pressed to find any major scientist in America who wasn't an acceptor of natural branching evolution.
Hmm. All righty. 20 minutes in. Here we go.
That book covers the great turning point in history, if you like the history of stuff. Well, James Hutton's book that he wrote had a real strong influence on a young lawyer from Scotland named Charles Lyell.
Ah.
Charles Lyell, the lawyer, hated the Bible. Somebody calculated one time that if all the lawyers in the world were laid end to end around the equator, we would all be better off.
Oh, gosh, I got to pull a drink on that one.
Okay.
No, he didn't hate the Bible. In fact, he was one of the more conservative people in the biological world or geological world who balked at a lot of the atheistic implications of Darwinism, and he particularly had trouble figuring out how human beings originated. So right off the bat, Mr. doesn't study the details enough. Kent Hovind is misrepresenting Lyell's position.
And that information was clear. Now, remember earlier we were talking about whether he knows what he's saying is false or whether he really swallows it all. Would this not be an indication, since the information was freely available, that perhaps he is intentionally deceptive?
Oh, no. The information is freely available, but Doofus doesn't research.
Okay.
He'll listen to his videos. This guy does not research. He only looks at a very narrow... He researches in the same way Donald Trump researches voting records.
So he swallows whatever he's told, which is a skill he carried over to prison.
Oh, my.
Oh, boy.
Do we need the music again?
I can't beat that joke. I can't beat that joke. You win.
I win all of the internet points every show. I'm sorry.
Well, we got to do something with him.
Not only does Hovind swallow it all, he then spits it back out all over his audience.
All right. You know what? I'm hitting play. That's enough of this.
This is $9.95 a minute.
We all have to try.
We're going to be making money on this.
Welcome to SciStrike. For only $9.95 a minute, you can have all the hottest chat on the internet.
Look, we all have to try and sleep after this, and there's not enough alcohol in the world to cover this kind of talk. So, all right, here we go.
Charles Lyell, in 1830, wrote this book right here, Principles of Geology. I've got it here on the table. You can come take a look at it. It's all marked up. In this book, you can see his hatred for the Bible kind of ooze off every page. He kept calling it ancient doctrines. He said, oh, you have a scripture.
What? But aren't they? I mean...
Is that copyright 2000 textbook?
Could be, which by now is...
Yeah, I'll put in a fellow. How many have heard of Adam Sedgwick?
I've heard the name. I probably know about him. I was too tired to recall it.
I've heard of Kira Sedgwick.
He's one of the major geologists of the early 19th century. In fact, Darwin studied under him. Very devout. In fact, he was a preacher on the side. And he also knew that the science data that they were uncovering in his period didn't fit. Earth could only be 6,000 years old. And this is the issue that Kent just can't address. He correctly can point out that the scientists of late 18th and early 19th century were giving up on the old religious framework because it was wrong. It was completely incompatible with the science data. What Kent leaves out, in part because the people he siphons leaves it out, but also because he has the curiosity of a block of wood to research any of it, is that there was a mountain of science data on geology and the distribution of animals and the number of species that was just blowing to smithereens the old pre-scientific view that was reflected in the Bible. And these guys, very devout people by and large, were trying to get a grip on it. Hovind, not that. He can take the old-time religion and just flush down the toilet all the data he never bothers to look at.
All right. Here we go. And we're getting near cutting them off.
Cultural authority, he was mocking them, okay? He called it a religious prejudice. He said, men of superior talent, he's talking about himself, who thought for themselves and were not blinded by authority, he used every opportunity he could find to mock the scriptures. And kids, you won't have to go to college very far before you're going to run into a professor that has this mocking attitude toward God's word.
Back that up to his quotes.
Back it up to his quotes.
Yeah, that's too far.
Too far? All right, let's move forward.
His book that he wrote had a
real
strong influence on a young lawyer from Scotland named Charles Lyell.
Oh, Jesus.
Charles Lyell, go to college very far before you're going to run into a...
Did we pass it?
I'm not sure.
Professor that has this mocking attitude toward God. It's one where he had the highlight where he's interpolating stuff.
Oh, roboting a bit. What'd you say, sir?
Is it referring to the part where he's interpolating material like himself, or he's adding in?
Yes.
He's playing with the audience because he wants to lead them by the nose to arrive at the spot he wants to do. I'm not entirely sure what Lyle may have been referring to. He could just as easily have been pointing out that it was religious doctrines that were thinking the earth was the center of the universe, that it didn't turn on its axis. That had also been overturned by the sciences, and people had to get used to that, that Aristotle was wrong, and that the heliocentric model was actually correct. And it's no coincidence that there are people who are just as sloppy thinkers as Kent Hovind, saying that the earth must indeed be the center of the universe, that geocentrism is in fact correct because the Bible teaches that. So the idea that it's just the age of the earth that is being challenged by the new science, Hovind is never going to tell his audience about that part.
All right. Okay.
Since you just covered it, I think we can skip it now. Steal my thunder like that? How dare you?
I'm a thunder stealer. I majored in that in college.
Strike while the iron is hot.
Yeah, well, at least I still have all the internet points.
That you do.
God's word. How many of you had one when you went through school? Seems like their whole goal in life is to destroy your faith. I had a bunch of them when I went to school. They just wanted to destroy your confidence. Well, Charles said his goal was to free the science from Moses. What do you suppose he meant by that? Well, before Charles Lyell wrote his book,
the idea that college is the movie God's Not Dead.
Jesus, you sound like Donald Trump.
Except, of course, that movie hadn't been made yet, so this is very prescient.
Aha. Here we go.
Look, everybody looked at the geology, looked at Grand Canyon, and said, wow, look at the flood did. He didn't like people interpreting Earth's history in light of the Bible. He wanted them to interpret Earth's history in terms of millions of years. Lyell is the primary guy responsible for inventing what today is known as the geologic column. How many have ever heard of the geologic column before?
Drink. Oh, boy. There, you're really skirting really, really close to bearing false witness there, Ken, because I can't imagine, even if you were paying attention to John Morris and Henry Morris and the other creationist gangs that you're siphoning off of, you can't possibly be thinking that Lyell invented the geologic system all on his own. Those various periods are made up. Part of them, Sedgwick was involved, Murchison. There were a whole bunch of other geologists that were involved in working out those terminologies because they were the ones doing the work, and the details they were uncovering couldn't be fit into an old-style biblical framework. That's why the biblical framework was becoming increasingly irrelevant by the time you were in 1830. Mm.
Somebody's having big microphone issues, and we're hearing a lot of chatter and stuff.
Yeah, I think it's the mold.
Hmm. All right. We'll try and narrow it down to who. That's gone at the moment. All right. Here we go.
Sounds like somebody's snoring, actually.
That's might be me. I may be asleep. I'm not entirely sure.
Did someone pass out from drinking?
It's happened before.
It's You're very talkative for a man in a stupor. That's amazing.
I will tell you, if I'm dreaming this, and Kent is in, I blame you guys for that. All right, here we go.
Boy, if this is the best you can do on a dream, that's a failure, boy.
That's what I'm saying. All right.
Four. They divided the Earth up into layers and gave them names, you know. Cenozoic, Mesozoic, Paleozoic, Archaeozoic, all that kind of stuff. Maybe you saw the movie Jurassic Park, named after the Jurassic layer. Okay. Each layer of rock was given a name and an age.
Oh, did Hold you on. Have a... Yes?
Yeah, Mole, it's your mic, so can you mute when you're not talking? Because I see the thing spiking up and it's all the interference is coming from you. Mole, you there?
I think he's out.
I think he's sleeping.
That might be it. He might be sleeping, and we're hearing him snore.
Use your muting power.
This is the problem with Hangouts: is we can't give him shaving cream from his hand and tickle his nose.
We could try and be really loud.
You can mute him now.
That I can. Where the heck is he?
I can also point out that the idea of doing stratigraphy, that rocks on the bottom are tending to be older than the rocks on the top, and a time frame is involved, that was worked out by Nicholas Steno, who was a deeply religious guy, not an evolutionist, a very nice Bible-believing guy, who was trying to explain back in the 1500s and 1600s why their neighborhood looked the way it was. And you'll notice that Kent Hovind doesn't try to explain why Tennessee or Pensacola, Florida looks the way it does. He's scampering off to the Grand Canyon and from a mile above and deciding he can figure out all about it without actually consulting the fine point details, except for the stuff he's copied from creationist literature.
Indeed. All right. A few more minutes and I've had it with this fellow. Here we go.
And an index fossil. Now keep in mind, all this was done in 1830 before there ever was a carbon dating, potassium argon dating, rubidium strontium dating, lead 208, lead 206, uranium 235, uranium 238. None of those had even been thought of. So they didn't determine these great ages by any radiometric decay method. They just picked the numbers out of the clear blue sky.
Drink.
It's a fact.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead, Canales. Take a whack at it first.
Okay. So they did not at all just decide these numbers out of thin air. I'm not a geologist. I don't know the specifics, but I have taken a college earth science class at UC Berkeley. And it's nowhere near just picking dates out of thin air. The different layers within the rock, you can tell because you compare them to other regions. There are different dating methods when you find things trapped in the rock. There's this, that, and the other. It's RJ, you know this better than me. You know the specifics. You know the sciencey words. I'll give it to you.
Yeah, I will just mention again, Sicker Point, S-I-C-C-A-R. You can Google it. You can find material on it. There's an enormous amount of Paul Braderman has done a really magnificent set of posts up on his website about Sicker Point, going into the details with pictures of the site that far from pulling numbers out of their hat, and if anybody pulls something out of something other than a hat, it's Kent Hovind, you've got issues of where you know how You can observe how quickly erosion takes place. You can observe how quickly particles form. You can observe all the little fiddly bit details. Sicker Point was this weird deposit up on the coast of Scotland that had layer cake deposits and chevron nodes of where things had been eroded and tilted and other things laid on top of it and eroded and tilted. This incredibly complex piece of real estate that no way in any possible flood scenario could all of this been produced all in one big gush. And it's no coincidence that Hovind has never mentioned deposits like that, and the very few people even in the creationist literature even try to get within a mile of it, including Andrew Snelling, because it can't be explained by flood geology. And that's even before we get to interbedded airborne volcanic ash, which is the coup de grace for any flood theory.
Okay. Anybody else? All right. Here we go.
The Earth has many layers of sedimentary rock. That is just a fact. You can see them all over Tennessee here. How'd they get there? Well, there are two interpretations. One group says the layers form slowly over millions of years. The other group says, no, these layers are all from the flood in the days of Noah. And again, they're always trying to erase that line between the two and make their interpretation become part of the fact. And it's just not, okay? It's just their interpretation, that's all. The geologic column is actually the Bible for the evolutionist. The only place you'll ever find it is in the textbooks. It doesn't exist. This guy admits it. He said, if there were a column of sediments, unfortunately, no such column exists.
Oh,
you know there is.
Drink.
Okay. Do I have to have five
John
drinks for this one?
Wrap. Oh, my favorite little creationist, RJ here. Boy, at last you've cited somebody, my all-time favorite nincompoop, John Woodmorap, a.k.a. Jan Pexis, who actually has done paleontology work and published in regular paleontology journals under his normal name, Jan Pexis. John Woodmorap is actually his nom de plume that he writes as a creationist. When he would get his articles cited, he would then cite, John Woodmorap would cite Jan Pexis. Pexis has all of this pro-evolution propaganda. This is an example of the bad science. So he's using himself as a sock puppet. Crap, I got a whole long section on him. He is one of the most manipulative, evasive, hopscotching guys in the entire anti-evolution literature. And of all the people on Earth for you to cite, Dr. Dino, I thank you for going on the Woodmorap bandwagon.
Okay. Got fairly excited over that one. Nicely done.
He's heating plan, the stall booking plan for Noah's Ark, God of the Noah's Ark, a feasibility study, the book that he did in 1996. And he never quite figures out how many animals are on board the Ark or any of the little fiddly bit details. And that's the best they can do. Woodmorap is, by the way, the only creationist field who's tried to take on the reptile mammal transition since Dwayne Gish, and boy does he fail miserably. You've got my book, you can read about John Morap. He's got a ton of stuff in there on him.
Indeed.
I think we find a touchy subject.
Woodmorap. I despise Woodmorap. Gosh, he's a weird guy.
RJ called five drinks for one issue. This, he was very serious about this. All right, here we go.
Can we do another video about cameras where I know what's going on?
If there was, it'd be 100 miles thick. It doesn't exist. It's one of the lies in the textbooks. And actually, all of evolution is based on this lie right here. This is one of the most serious ones, in my opinion. It's true the Earth has layers. That's not the question. Okay. How did they get there, though? I mean, if that layer sat there for 10 million years waiting for the next one, don't you think it's going to rain once in a while in 10 million years?
Oh, geez. Okay. Only one. Okay. I was afraid you were going to call five again.
Like the rock is waiting there for something. It's just sitting around. No, it's doing the rock thing. It's there because it's there. And there may or may not, the reason why we can now see sections of it exposed is because that watery stuff came along and eroded it away. You know, earlier he mentioned the idea that all the rock layers would be 10 miles thick or 100 miles thick if they were all in one place. He forgets the fact that erosion is taking place as well as deposition. So it depends on when and where all of that happens. That's like saying I have a year of on my yard that I have to shovel away. And if that stuff accumulated, why, I would have miles of snow on my driveway. That's because it doesn't stay there indefinitely. And so the it shows inadequacy of Hogan world in obsessing about the tiny details of a geologic deposit without actually discussing the tiny details. Explain the damn Coconino deposit inside of there. It's impossible to explain in a flood context.
Indeed. And I'm not quite sure if all this was hardening all at once from the Great Flood, how there'd be such clear boundaries between layers. I mean, wouldn't there have been quite a bit of mixing if such a thing were true? Why
it looked like leaving the Neapolitan ice cream out in the sun. You'd get just a big, smushy, mushy muck.
Pretty much.
You wouldn't get failed deposits.
Indeed. All righty.
Why are there no erosion marks between the layers? Why are they stacked on top of each other just like a stack of pancakes? And by the way, why are there no soil layers between the rock layers? I mean, soil builds up on top of rock. Don't you think there'd be some soil built up once in a while?
Oh, dear, dear. Look. Oh, I got to call another drink on this one. I'm sorry. Oh, boy.
No,
RJ
you're not.
Here. That's because they're marine deposits. You're not going to find soil. They've got trilobites in them. They're not terrestrial deposits when they were laid down. And they can tell that because the way particles are laid down is very precise. Deposits that are formed in rivers, in estuaries, in low shores, in deep benthic sediments or aeolian windblown deposits, they all have very specific ways of depositing. And they can see this because they've performed experiments to confirm it. And it's been known for the last 100 years, if you ever bothered to read a science paper, Kent. Oh, my. So, no, I don't expect to find soil in a deposit underwater, just as I don't expect to find science knowledge anywhere in your neurons.
Does anyone notice that Kent is sounding more and more like Kermit the Frog as this goes on?
This is Kent Hogan the clown here. There's no there in the flood.
Bye. Rocka rocka.
All right.
If you get a jar of dirt and rocks and gravel and sand and mud and shake it up and set it down, it settles into layers for you in a few minutes. It doesn't take long. How many seen those things you buy?
And how long does it take for all of it to turn into rock? Just curious.
At the mall with two pieces of glass and different colored sand
in
between.
Hold on a second.
Oh, yes.
It's funny because he's literally just describing the process by which these things formed. He's saying it supports his bullshit. Somebody just put up, don't insult Kermit. Makes me giggle. He's correct. All these layers formed through sedimentation when this mass was in the ocean before it moved up and was pushed up, became land. He just seems to think that this supports his conclusion. He's leaving out enough steps that it supports his conclusion.
I think when he was holding up go ahead.
The fun thing is that even if you go way up the creationist food chain to your Andrew Snellings, the guy with real live geology degree from a real live science institution and still publishes in regular science journals, you know, not with his creationist hat on, they don't really get any more detail. They can't explain any of the little fiddly bits any better. Although Snelling, because he did know about this airborne volcanic ash stuff that occurs all over the planet in various deposits, he decided there had to be more than one flood. And boy, did that hit a buzzsaw back in the 1990s. And he's had to back off of that little puppy ever since.
But well, you need to look no further than the White Cliffs of Dover, which are literally made out of billions upon trillions upon trillions of of just skeletons of diatoms.
In fact, are another example of the we can see how geology landscapes are not just an undifferentiated muck. They reflect the place that the critters lived at the time they lived. And so you don't find everything mushed together, everything all together in one environment. Some things were under the sea, then later on they were not, because it becomes dry land. And then you can see the ripple marks of things, and you can see the sediment as you form estuaries. And there's just a gigantic amount of technical literature, which nowadays in the internet era, you can find online freebie if you go hunting around for this stuff, to where you can see them describing the detailed landscapes of the past. And that's so far removed from this vague, undifferentiated, I think he thinks everything is that little teeny picture he's holding there. That's the geology. I don't have to actually start looking at things through a microscope. I've just got a little picture that I've got of something that where its sediment layers out just fine. And that explains everything.
Growing up as a young earther, I can tell you that there's one thing worse than sitting in a hard church pew listening to someone speak, and that's having them speak about geography or geology. If you could have, like, these people are not interested in fact checking when they get home. They are interested in any being anywhere else. They count on that. They count on that we're too bored and that we don't care. And
I do want to quickly correct us. We said that the cliffs of Dover are diatoms, and they're actually coccolithophores, which are slightly different.
Oh, yes, we sit corrected here on that one.
Yeah. They're calcium carbonate skeletons anyway.
You know, about diatoms in general, that reflects a whole huge sea change that was taking place in the Cretaceous systems as those things were evolving during that period. You don't find them way earlier. And some deposits, for example, there was a new organism that came along, I think about 800 or 900 million years ago or so, that developed a technique for latching on to phosphorus, and it sucked it out of the oceans. And that's why these chert deposits that were occurring earlier disappeared, because these little critters were just siphoning off the chemicals that make them. So every one of these forms a logical landscape. And this is way removed from the stuff that was being done. Any 19th century geologist like Lyell or Sedgwick, if they were brought forward in a time machine and look at the drivel that you see in a Kent Hovind tape versus the technical literature that's done in the regular geology journal, they won't have any time at all to figure out which one's doing the science and which one's blowing smoke rings.
Yeah, and the calcium carbonate levels of the ocean are – so this is another thing where it comes down to basic science, and climate change also has a lot to do with it. And you tie all this together, you see why so many fundamentalists are against climate change, because if they believe in climate change, it'll fuck up their other ideas. But the chemical composition of the ocean determines the percentage of calcium carbonate in the ocean. You can look at the calcium carbonate compensation of the ocean over time by looking at the rock strata, looking at the different levels. And who has taken a piss now?
Whoever it is.
Why is somebody doing that while I'm talking?
Please mute. I mean, we understand, but mute. It's the buttons, Jesus. The button is right there. All right. Oh,
anyway, so it's a whole long thing. I don't want to go into the specifics of ocean, you know, chemical composition and all that, but it all ties together. It's a big circle. It all is a bunch of it's the circle of bullshit for fundamentalists.
Indeed. Thank you, Urzef. She is explaining that they take anti-scientific videos like this is Kent Hovind on Evangelical Creationist and MST3K the shit out of them. Thank you for explaining to the other readers what we are trying to do in our oh-so-clumsy way.
Indeed. And Spacey Nerd, do not take Kent Hovind as representative of what you should expect to see here when you undoubtedly return. I promise. our policy has always been we were going to watch them cold. Whatever we're going to watch, we watch them cold and go through them as they... I think just, not everybody, just me, I think I will review them first to make sure we don't run into the tedium and drudgery that we're running through tonight.
Well, I'm sorry, but a three-hour video, you should have... with a three-hour video, I think you really should have... vetted a little bit.
Oh yeah. In that respect, but in the past we've had some long ones, but the stupid was coming hard and fast to where they'd say something that was absolutely anti-science. We could refute it right away, move on to the next one.
Yeah, Kent, it's no coincidence that Eric Hovind is condensing the drivel down to a kind of a glossy clickbait version that only runs about 20 minutes. But Kent is in the old school, and he would basically be filming his evangelical lectures, which always mixed about 50% Bible thumping and scripture quoting into the PowerPoint, along with the tiny little blibbits of silence. And 2 hours is very typical, and he did this for years and years and years. It's just a colossal amount of these things that have now been fragmented and chopped up into stuff that's on YouTube. But boy, this is there's a whole generation of creationists that have been steeped in Kent Hovind over the years. He's way more popularly known than anything at Answers in Genesis or Institute for Creation Research.
Indeed.
He's also a raging dickhole.
Now that is a terrible, insulting thing to say about raging dick holes there, Canada.
Well, they have to be fair, it's not inaccurate. That was his job in prison.
Oh my. Stop it or Kevin's gonna cue up the tunes again.
Wait, is that what we're going for?
Oh my god.
Indeed was a hole for dicks.
And there it goes.
Yeah, I don't know if any of you have seen Orange is the New Black. Just replace the main character there with Kent Hovind. Oh, yeah.
All right.
I'd like to introduce
you. Yeah, are you going to erode my straight up? Well, let's see.
Kent Hovind's story is a mix of that old documentary Bible Camp with Orange is the New Black and Deliverance.
I was wondering if you were going to fit Deliverance.
Like this, if you can talk about Hovind.
All right. You know what I say?
Jesus Camp. I was thinking of.
Let's give.
Thank you, Ursus. It's a male name, Ursus the Bear. I'm sorry. I somehow thought of it as my apologies, Urs.
Okay. Here we go.
I'm trying to read the photo on the side.
Yeah. Let's.
We have been sitting here watching him hold that photo for a while now.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, that's not a photo. By the way. You guys may not recognize what that is. That's one of those multicolored sand things in water that you flip upside down and, you know, the sand pours down. That's not actually a picture, I think.
Oh, so if he flips it over, you get to see the naked lady.
Right. Not that kind of thing.
it looks like a chipmunk drowning.
For the easily amused, you flip it over and see the sand in the layers. See, it's got layers. That's what he was trying to... He was trying to make clear. When you flip it over, the sand doesn't all just drop down immediately. It pours down in a little spout and makes something very similar to what you see here at the other side. It's one of those, it's for the easily amused, you can spend minutes with such a thing. All right, here we go.
God, I just can't help wondering if the books that he's got on there, those little markers along the side, is that information he's plugged on his own volumes, or are those suspiciously like the little things that are on the Dewey Decimal Guide at the library? Has he been stealing books from the library? Oh, dear.
Could be. So there's coveting going on.
It's another anti-creationism book. I got to steal it.
Well, he's actually paying his taxes. I'm sure he didn't want a paper library card either.
Ursula.
It's a crocodile diving fish.
Ursula corrected himself.
All right. Let's give him one more assertion then. Okay. We're a half
hour. You said that 2 assertions ago.
We'll give. Yeah. Do you want to give one more assertion or go to the silliness that was supposed to be the palate cleansing that Paul was kind
My
enough to bring
My
choice
is looking better and better every minute.
All right.
Yeah, I think we can go to palate cleanser because
we'll go to palate cleanser.
Kent ain't gonna get any better. He's gonna just on and on and on like this.
I have to agree. And from this point
Angels?
Forward, I will.
Hold up, psychic cloak.
No. This is one from Paul, and it's
as well as psychic cloak, by the way. So you know, they're commonly themed.
Everyone have your psychic cloaks on.
Oh, Kent Hovind wishes he had his psychic cloak of protection in prison.
Hey, don't make fun of Hovind's mud flap.
All right.
On to tale.
So everyone want to say goodbye to Mr. Hovind here. We'll wish him well.
Goodbye, Dr. Dino.
Dr. Dino on his
You're
way.
You're a disgrace to paleontology.
All right. And I promise I will review videos, every video, It's just that's going to limit my ability to comment off the cuff, but you guys are great at that, so that won't be a problem. All right. Here comes the palate cleansing silliness to wrap things up.
Hello.
Hi.
So I wanted to talk tonight a little bit about fossils that are found in the ground.
Okay.
Okay, Drake. And, hold on a second.
As opposed to found where else?
This is sky fossils
in the air, fossils floating around in the atmosphere. I keep on bumping to them all the time, along with the bats.
Hold on, you guys, it gets way worse. But hold on, this is actually shot in vertical video. Is there a way to make it like not weird?
No.
Okay.
The only reason that's no is because RJ kept calling five drinks at a time.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Not really, but I am.
That's quite all right. All right. She's okay. So
all right, she's cuter when she's, you know, at least somewhat in perspective.
She's a little wider.
She leaned over the table.
This is her anamorphic mode. She's in CinemaScope.
Yeah, she's cuter in 16:9.
All right.
Yeah, you're in 69.
Here we go.
16:9.
Oh, it starts already.
Yeah, you started.
I guess I'll start a little bit about what the fossils actually are, and then go into a little bit about the composition and what they end up being when everything is said and done. So a fossil is not actually
air
a
quotes.
Piece of bone.
Right.
A fossil is actually a bone that was once in the ground that has been then filled with limestone, calcium, and other kind of stone-like deposits over the course of many, many years. And at the end of the day, it ends up looking like a bone, but it's not really a bone. It's really a rock inside of rock. So you have a rock this big, and you say, okay, inside this rock this big, there's a bunch of fossils. Here you go. And you hand the rock off to a paleontologist, and the paleontologist takes a little mallet, and they chip away at it, and at some point, they come out with something looking like a bone, and that's a fossil. So here's the question that I pose. Now, the first fossil that was ever found was actually after they came up with the idea of a dinosaur.
Right. Drink!
A little bit.
Okay.
It's about time, RG.
I was worried about you there.
Oh, yeah. My. If you could see my face, I am one of these going, the Lord hath delivered her unto my hands. Boy, that is so completely cockamamie, perennial blockage of the rectum wrong. The first dinosaur fossils were known long before they were ever called dinosaurs. They go back for centuries. They were well known in the literature. It was only in the 19th century that they started figuring out that the little critters that they were seeing in there were representative of something other than a conventional reptile. And Richard Owen, particularly in the early 19th century, who was, by the way, by any standards, kind of a creationist, coined the term dinosaur. So you're right off the bat. What do you want to guess that this lady has not actually studied the history of paleontology? And her dress reminds me of somebody I've encountered on Twitter that I just tweeted to for one of the stupid things that she said on some science evolution matter. So I think I may have, and she was, is she a flat earther, by the way?
No, she's not. Sai, did you get the channel name here, by the way? Did you see the channel name?
I did at the time, but I did not. It's Christian.
The channel name, just so you know, is Christians Against Dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Cat. Oh, okay. Yeah, I think I heard the voice from another
direction. There's a sci-fi channel movie I want to see. There.
Actually, Ken Ham put that into the. That's how he got in trouble with the USA Today. He actually has Christians versus dinosaurs
in the arena. Yep.
In the arena. Yep.
Yeah. The notion if she's representing that group that says that dinosaur fossils aren't real, that they're just made up things, that's actually an extremely very fringe view. Regular creationists, these scientific creationists, don't accept that at all. They acknowledge that the critters involved represent real animals. They died in the flood. Blah blah blah. So she's representing the kind of the wackaloon fringe part of the wackaloon fringe.
I see.
That's off of Pink Floyd's last album.
The Wackaline friends.
All right, talk amongst yourselves. The mug of truth is empty.
Oof, the moly.
Mole's back.
Yeah, you guys got to give me like dick joke fodder here. I can't just pull them out of thin air.
But we don't have Hovind on screen anymore.
No. He is gone.
Should we come up with a script for our sitcom of Kent Hovind in prison?
I think we get to cast Kirk Cameron as Kent Hovind.
I think this is going to be a sound effect, though.
Okay. All right. Well, I think we've wandered off of the science trail here.
Let's see what she has to tell us about fossils.
All right, somebody ramble on for a little bit longer. As I mentioned, the mug. Thanks to RJ, the mug of truth is empty.
No, just keep in mind, I'm actually refraining from a lot of bone jokes here.
Long even on the notion that all fossil bones are no longer bone, that they're all rock. If she had known anything that the real paleontologists do, is that sometimes you will actually find original bone material still retained inside of even full-blown fossils. And that's, in fact, where all of that claptrap about soft tissues is.
Okay. Well, first, David A.R. White as Kent Hovind's cellmate in our little sitcom, because I've always wanted to direct a Kent Hovind, David A.R. White sex scene. And number two... Should I just play the porno music through the whole video? This one.
No.
I
mean,
we're gonna be talking about bones.
If she really wants to find a new fossil, all she's got to do is go flash an old guy. He'll give her an old bone.
You know,
one of my favorite weird things that creationists outside of her narrow frame do that I've heard weirdly often, and even the Native American creationist Vinnie Deloria made this dumb remark. He says, "Why is it that bones are always found?" Because that's where you see them. You know, I suppose if you want, you can excavate the entire planet and you'll find lots more bones inside of there. But typically, the scientist kind of waits until something erodes out and they try to catch it before it entirely disintegrates, because they don't have a lot of money to do and they have to kind of run after them the best they can.
Could very well be. Or they could be just carving bone shapes out of rock, as she asserts. Could, I guess, that's the other side of the issue. Like Kent was saying, we don't want to just put forth one side of the issue. All right.
Yeah, let's see her debate Kent Hovind. That would be amusing to see. I'd bring popcorn.
Do you think Kent puts out both sides of the issue in prison?
No. Yeah.
I've already covered that. He is definitely a receiver.
I'm just going to warn everybody, you do not want to Google Eiffel Tower. Safe search on.
A lot of good advice comes from you, Kevin. Right. Here we go.
Washington Monument in here, too, and some obelisks.
Oh, God. Okay. I don't want to tell RJ what that is. I'll let him Google later.
Oh, I shudder to think of what sort of filthy things will await me if I do such a task, young man.
The internet is a great thing.
All right. Back to the wide girl here.
Right? Why would the bone that was found, or the fossil that was found, actually be the exact same thing as what was originally hypothesized?
Continuation of the earlier statement.
Evidence. It doesn't make any sense. So now I give to you. Here. You're my paleontologist.
Here it comes.
What the?
Turn that into what it was before I ripped it apart. Here. You can have some spackle too. As much spackle as you want. Here, turn this.
Do you have something to add, Kevin?
No, just I love that she chose spackle. She didn't spring for super glue. She just went straight to her garage and pulled out spackle.
But the terrible irony is, and this is long before you ever get into modern paleontology, this is the stuff that was noticed back in the 19th century about when they started looking with those little microscopy things. that bones have very specific structures, and you could bring in a fragment of a bone to Richard Owen or Baron Cuvier, and they could reconstruct what animal it was from, because bones are that specific. And although people don't take the rock and hit them with sledgehammers to create pulverized muck like this, you do have instances of where the animal has been broken up in the area of deposition. And this, or for that matter, it occurs most often with the hominid skulls, where a hyena or something is killing the animal, and the hominid ends up as a fragmentary bone structure. The scientists can, in fact, meticulously reconstruct bit by bit by bit the little puzzle to make the whole picture in there. And it requires expertise and skill, but no spackle is involved.
No spackle.
They're spackle-free, although they do actually use plaster of Paris in covering over a bone. When they find a really good deposit, they'll chop a huge chunk of it out, and they'll pack the whole bloody thing up, and they need a crane, because often these things weigh tons. And then only when they get back to the laboratory do they start taking things apart in details. The stuff that they can get directly is the stuff that's directly weathered out. And there again, it's a matter of quick time, because paleontologists tend to want to go back to the same area year after year after year, unless people are shooting at them, which sometimes happened, like in Pakistan. They can pick up stuff because every year some new material is being eroded out, and they can get wonderful fossils and get stuff that they didn't get the first time around. But no spackle.
You know why they don't use spackle, don't you? Because they found out that if they wait for Hovind to take a shower, and then he can either just spit on it or fart on it, it'd be even better.
Okay, this is this is starting to happen at the end of every show. Have you noticed?
Yes, you know, Hovind farts are actually banned in the Geneva Convention. I hope you realize this.
I'm an American. I don't recognize the Geneva Convention.
Yeah, I've never been to Switzerland.
No, it's the La Haye Convention that Americans don't accept.
I know. Don't ruin my joke, Tal. Why would you do that to me?
Oh, because
I'm a political scientist. I know this.
Because I have to call the night, so I'm too tired. So good night, everyone, and I watch the rest tomorrow.
There's not much more. This is the light fare to wrap it all up.
I think I've seen this video before. This one's a short one. I can't say short and sweet, because that is not an adjective you should use to describe this.
Agreed, but yes, it is very short. We're already more than 2/3 through it, believe it or not. So this is the light fare.
It's taken 20 minutes.
This is to recover from Hovind. All right. So you're heading out then, sir?
There's like 90 seconds, Tal.
Yeah. Yeah, here we go.
Into what it's supposed to be. All right. Who knows what you're going to come up with, right? Now, here, take this same substance, this same spackle, and, by the way, it's supposed to be this little guy, Brachiosaurus, he's 40 meters tall.
Take this substance, this spackle,
to make a dachshund with a long neck.
Oh, yeah, let's see if you can do some arts and crafts.
Chances are, what are you going to come up with? If you want to keep your job, you come up with a Brachiosaurus skull. If you want to be truthful...
And would you recognize a Brachiosaurus skull if you saw one?
Was there an actual call for drink for this silliness?
Yes.
Okay, Tao, go right. No. Good, Tao, go ahead.
I think she missed quite a bit of parts for making a brain of a giant dinosaur.
I believe so, and maybe a little more spackle, too.
You know, you need all that spackle in there. You know how much spackle you need? You need about 5 or 6 tubs worth, because it's going to get messy.
Wait a minute, what that lady can do with a caulking gun.
Oh, yeah. And you don't want to see her when she gets into the glue.
Or when she gets dirty.
All right, I'm hitting play.
Whatever it was that I smashed the parts against. When millions of dollars are on the line, which one are you going to do? My guess is you're going to go with the Brachiosaurus. That's where the money is. So.
Oh, break! Oh, drink, drink, drink! This one I can't resist. That's wow, fine. You know. As every budding paleontologist knows, the great road to wealth is to become a paleontologist. Yeah, the kids, forget your rap artists, forget your movie stars, forget your football players. Boy, you want to find the riches, become a paleontologist. At which point, the roars of laughter from the paleontologists scrambling for tiny amounts of funding for their material will say, are you eating the spackle? Are you sniffing the spackle to think that?
And they get all the girls.
Oh, yes. There are paleontologist groupies.
Although Paul Sabino is something of a hunk, I will say that.
Hmm. All right. Last 10 seconds.
This was insightful for what happens on a daily basis in the world of paleontology. Thank you very much for listening, and I will see you next time.
Okay.
She studies on a daily basis anything in the paleontology world. She just reads those Journal of Paleontology and Vertebrate Paleontology magazines up the yin-yang in between finding spackle at Home Depot.
Sai, we've only gone for 2 hours and 15 minutes at this point. I think we need some cloaks.
You want the cloak of invisibility? See, I was thinking to just let everybody peacefully and happily forget that which has just been imposed upon you. I was thinking.
Yeah, the unicorns.
Happy gold.
There you go. Now everybody's happy again. But do you really want? You really want the psychic cloak again? You're gonna insist that game happens again, aren't you?
We didn't. I didn't get my psychic cloak last week. I feel like I really need it.
He wants to have that freeze frame. He needs that freeze frame.
That's what I'm talking about. All right. Mm-hmm. let me find the psychic cloak. And all right, here we go. Psychic cloak.
See you, Tao. Bye.
All right. Now is it?
It was fucking over. You all lied to me.
Do you just want to watch the psychic cloak, or are you guys going to assist?
Is there a link for this nutter? I think there is one for that lady, because I've seen her online.
Search for Christians Against Dinosaurs on YouTube.
Yeah, somebody remind me to stick that in the description as well. But all right, now
the masochists out there that really want to see her again.
Yeah, and
she has plenty more. There's a lot more to be mined there if you want.
And they're all short, I've noticed. We could do a whole series of those at some point. Anything's better than Hovind. But, all right. I will, Kevin, I will give you your psychic cloak of protection.
Yay.
Only question I have is, are you guys going to insist on doing the calling drink with nothing after, only for the purpose of trying to stop the video at a particular point, or are you just going to let it play?
It was almost like a random phenomenon. I'll just let it run. I'll let you kids play on that one.
All right.
Okay, so here's my view of it. You may just watch a Hovind video, so yeah. I'm not going to say a damn word.
All right.
Kevin, play the music.
Sure.
That was my plan.
Either way, I'm getting another drink.
Sean, were you here for the particular game in question?
I get the feeling that you don't like it. So since you made us,
I'm
not going to stop it in any way.
It's pretty damn amusing. And Kevin, did you not win something last week that you failed to remind me of?
Oh, I did. I did. I forgot. I will send you an address later.
Send me a shipping address. Philip got his. It arrived at his in Texas. So he's going to have a Darwin fish on his vehicle in
Wee-hoo!
Texas. So any of you that are especially skilled in martial arts or have any particular weaponry, you might want to head out and hang out with Phil to make sure he's safe for a while.
Hey, I go to UC Berkeley, and we have Ann Coulter coming to the campus in April.
Really?
Yeah, after our famous Milo riot.
Hmm. All righty. Okay.
Be looting the hemp stores.
Same We might as well, because I know what's going to happen. Same contest as last week for one Darwin fish. First person to that calls drink that stops on that particular part of the video that we were talking about previously. Send somebody explain to Sean what this is all about.
Spacey nerd. It doesn't matter if you miss 75% of the stream. You're about to get the best part.
All right. And this is, okay. First one to call it at that point, which might as well just disclose it because Sean was not here. If you stop the video on the O face, you win the Darwin fish. It was Kevin last week. So, or was it last week? Yeah, last week. Here we go. Yeah. Starting up.
Hey, Melanie Beckler here with ask-angels.com.
Hi, Melanie.
Let's talk about psychic cloaking.
Oh, no, that's not quite. Not quite. Not
okay,
quite.
Okay.
Yeah, she's still at spackle level.
All right. Very good. It's, you know, it's too bad the chat has a lag on it, because it would be good to let them play too, wouldn't it?
Yeah, anyway. It would.
All right. Here we go.
Believe it or not, I am in Las Vegas, Nevada at the moment. And
but
so this
why?
Seems like
why
the
are
perfect
you in
opportunity
Vegas,
to talk about wearing a psychic cloak. Miles what? And I are back in the U.S. and we're road tripping across the country.
Wait. Oh, no, this video again. Oh, no.
The game is on, Mace.
She's in Las Vegas because Philadelphia kicked her out.
What happened to Kevin, I thought there was going to be music for this.
Oh, I'm waiting until she starts talking about the cloak, you know.
All right, here we go.
Oh, yeah. Which is why we are in Vegas for the night before driving onward tomorrow. But anyway, because a psychic cloak is a form of psychic protection that not only shields, but also cloaks or hides your light energy from any lower or negative or dark forces.
Oh, protect
and the reason
yourself
I
from
thought that this
dark
would be relevant
forces,
to share in Las Vegas, Nevada, is because there's all sorts of weird energies that can be
weird
present here
energies. You
on
just don't
strip
want getting all
and
over
this
your body.
Really happens any time and any place people are drinking, because alcohol can kind of open these doorways for entities
oh,
and lower vibrations
opens
to enter
all
in.
The doorways,
so while you may have heard the phrase, "What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas," this isn't necessarily true.
All right, nobody.
Sometimes it can come home with you. Then you got to get that special shampoo with the tiny comb.
All right, now I can only assume people are waiting for a better moment to call stop to try and win. Holy crap! I think I won the fish. How can I win the fish? All right, you know what? I am disqualifying myself from the competition because this is a clear win. All right.
He's in the state of spackle interruptus.
Especially if you're not protecting your energy, because you can take on things like attachments or even entities that will go home with you and cause emotional disruptions, lower
oh, yeah,
vibrational
sometimes
energies,
really fuck with
cause
the old
challenges,
head,
clumsiness, all kinds of things. But what I want to talk to you about is how you can protect yourself against that, not only here in Vegas, but anytime you're in a crowded or busy place when you may want to shield your energy, but also
oh, yeah, sometimes you like to be around a group
from garnering any
home
unwanted attention from negative energies, negative people, or negativity in any form. Know that when you wear a cloak in this way, it does sort of, it's like the invisibility cloak that Harry Potter wears.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, so baby, and it doesn't mess with the fun
cloak
at all.
And then know that some people may not see you. So be careful with this if you use a
gotta
psychic
watch out with that cloak,
cloak
baby.
While you're
nobody
driving
you walking down
practice
the street
extra defensive driving, because you might find other people cutting you off because they simply
don't wear
see
it with the psychic
you're vibrating it's out of that level of awareness. Or walking around, if someone cuts you off, don't get upset. Just know that this can be a side effect of wearing a psychic cloak. So the reason you would want to do this above and beyond just wearing a psychic protected shield is if you sense that there are negative energies around that you just don't want to deal with or don't want to interact with or do the light work of releasing. So psychic cloak could be good to wear if you are going out to dinner somewhere and you walk in and there's a really heavy energy, but you want to have a conversation with the person you're with rather than clearing the building and clearing the energy. You can
always
cloak
wear
yourself,
your psychic cloak
the
on that
person
first
you're with
date,
to create a barrier of light protecting you. And the great thing about the cloak is within it, your vibration can shine brighter and brighter. You can shine the most brilliant, radiant heart light, expanding out, raising your vibration, connecting with the angels
connect that vibration with the angels.
Because here's the thing, when you shine your light brighter, you can in some cases attract lower vibrational entities or energies. Earthbound spirits may actually think you are the light, and so instead of going in,
did you call stop?
Yeah. Yeah,
is that a win?
No, that's close, but it's not a win.
He's just discovered that the batteries wore out on her psychic cloak. That's the expression.
All right,
for those double E's.
For the rest of it, of the video, if anyone is going to attempt to win the coveted Darwin fish for your vehicle, make sure you assertively and loudly yell stop so that I can hear you over the foolishness we're all engaging in. There we go.
Yeah, you hear that, Tal? You gotta really yelp it.
Really, just shout it out there, because you may have lost this one because of the delay in me stopping it.
Don't be afraid to let out a nice long yell.
To the light, they can attach to your energy instead of crossing over. Or some ankle biter, lower frequencies may try to mess with you. Please don't let this scare you. It's really not a big deal. It's just a little awkward. And this...
Ooh, that was close.
That was pretty close.
This is why we surround ourselves with light, to protect from these sorts of things. And know that if you do take on any lower vibrational energies, which a good sign of this is your mood drops, or you're just suddenly feeling off, call in the angels.
Oh yeah, when you got those bad vibrations, you ain't feeling so good.
I think I heard a stop.
I think that's a win.
A half a second earlier it would have been a shoe in.
Yeah, I know.
And that half a second, if you look at the research about, you know, drunk driving and all that and how much a drink delays response time, that's what it was. It would have won. It's RJ calling five drinks for one thing that caused this. I'd call this a win.
Sai's blaming it on the alcohol.
But that's a win. That was Tao. Tao, you got this one?
No, that would be me.
Who called it?
Me, Sean.
Oh, Sean, you called it. Nice. I couldn't hear. All right, good. You two are responsible for giving me a shipping address, and you will receive one shiny Darwin fish for your vehicle. You just have to promise to at least once drive through a creationist community. Here we go.
Of light flowing around you. Also, a psychic shower is a great way to cleanse your energy. As the water streams around you, imagine it's cleansing.
Oh, yeah, let that water stream around you, just like Donald Trump in Russia.
Dissolving, transmuting into the light. But back to the psychic cloak. To wear a psychic cloak is so simple. You simply ask, intend.
You simply place it on the tip and roll it.
The first time, I would recommend asking the angels to help you craft it. I actually have a psychic cloak of protection meditation with Archangel Michael inside of the Angel Solution or the Psychic Protection Course. But here's the basics. Archangel Michael, please cloak my energy with
rainbow. I think you broke everybody.
Golden light. And just like you would imagine Harry Potter putting on that cloak, it's like a garment of rainbow and golden light all around you, shielding your energy.
Stop, stop, stop.
Oh my god.
Hey!
You have a winner.
Oh, this is
a definite win.
This is a big win. This is an absolute. Okay, I was gonna. Yeah, thanks, guys. I can't see the screen. I'm getting teary eyed. All right, somebody who called stop. Stop sounds the same from all of you, huh?
That was me again.
Sean, look, I can't.
Sean, so you got keep, fair and square.
Fair
and round in this case.
This is an absolute win. The last one was not bad either. But I can't send. Look, keep in mind, in every one of these shows, I actively dissuade people from going to the Patreon. I tell them to show up. There's not an unlimited amount of money. One Darwin fish per customer, and this is definitely a win, wouldn't you say?
I want this one to be the Darwin fish. The other one I'll renege.
All right. You still own the internet. I mean, that's a plus. All right. This is,
oh my god,
most definitely a win. Yeah. All right. We'll wipe the eyes so I can see the screen.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Any and all negativity and you know.
Okay, wait, hold on a minute. We really have to start doing more of her videos.
There's a whole nothing. Channel.
I know. This is just the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life.
All right, we'll dig up some. But we got to say, I've been saying for a long time, We got to include this, the stuff from before. I mean, just not Hoven, no Hovens. The premise of all of this is to refute pseudoscience and to promote actual science. We got to include a lot of that stuff. So we're perfectly willing to do more of this fun, but we got to do it like this at the end.
Hey, Cy, have you done Expanding Earth yet?
Expanding Earth.
Have you not seen Expanding Earth Theory?
I have not seen Expanding Earth.
Oh, okay, next week, Expanding Earth Theory.
All right. Ooh. That
How
sounds.
How fast has it been expanding? And does that mean that I get a bigger lawn?
Yeah. Well, the oceans just get bigger. That's the premise. Is that Pangaea was the entire Earth? And anyway, it's great. We'll save it. It's good.
All right. Nice. Get some science going. Oh, and everybody, if there's any this goes for the folks in the just watching and commenting as well. Any little sciencey projects you've been working on? You know, last couple of we've been kind of highlighting that kind of stuff. Doesn't have to be something big. Just something to let people know the science is for everybody, not just folks in lab coats. All right. Let's back to the cloak.
And in all lower vibrational frequencies, this cloak allows love, light, goodness, joy, gratitude to permeate it. But any negativity is dispersed,
small enough that the bad stuff can't get through.
Cloak to do the opposite.
And inside this cloak, you can then open your heart confidently and boldly, knowing you're safe and protected, and you can shine brighter and brighter. Standing in your authentic truth, your light.
We really should do a complete voiceover for this, shouldn't we?
Yes.
Integrity and authenticity, shining, vibrant.
Yeah, like what's up?
Fully protected.
Oh yeah, you're going to shine and vibrate.
Ready to head into any dense or negative situation, shielded, cloaked with the rainbow and golden light of the divine,
turn the music up
assisted by the angels. Give this a
All
try.
This video needs is a subtonal.
What was
and
the
then
one
for our climax?
What was the one we watched last week that there was it was claimed to be a rocket on the shelf?
Oh, Daphne Daphne Rimmel.
That was
yes,
not a
the rocket. The rocket.
That was not a rocket.
That's what my mom told me when I went through her drawers.
It's a model rocket.
Cloaking in this way before, comment below and let me know about your experience, or if this is new to you, next time you go into a busy situation a big crowd where you would normally take on negative energies from others, work with the cycle your positive state, your high vibration, and just keep shining, because
next time you're hanging out underneath the highway overpass with 20 or 30
so
hobos
needed in the world. I hope this is helping you. I honor you. I bow to the divine light in you. Namaste. Comment below if you haven't already. Subscribe here on YouTube. Give this video a thumbs up, and then I will see you soon.
I would suggest all of us refrain from commenting below.
You know where she wants that thumb up.
Oh, yeah. God. The same place Kent Hovind used to.
All right.
At the moment.
Would that be called the Hovind Highway?
This is, okay, this does not bode well for science.
Are we sure Dr. Dino isn't a proctologist?
Well, to be fair, Ask Angels and Kent Hovind both have exactly the same register on the science meter.
Okay.
Yeah, so Si, I'm guessing you're not getting any of these monetized by YouTube with their new
policy. It's, well, in any case, we've come to that part of the, and Sean, I'm glad you're still here, and you'll know why in a second. It is, we have reached the portion of the show. I hate that word, portion. We have reached the part of the show where we traditionally do the shameless plugs. And Sean, what was the shameless plug that I promised Steve earlier? He's doing something big soon. Do you remember? Do you remember what that was? Again,
isn't it about the whole is Genesis history?
I don't think so. That's...
Are you talking about Steve McRae?
Yeah.
Oh, he's having some kind of debate. I'm not sure who it's with. I don't.
Oh, with True Empirism.
Yeah, that guy.
Okay. Steve McRae is. He was having a hangout earlier, and we're doing the since he's absent, we are doing the shameless plug for him. Let me look at the list and make sure he's not here, so I don't insult someone else besides Paul. But you were below. I cut some off. Unless I expand it like this, I didn't see you. Anyway, So Steve McRae, go see his channel. See that thing that was just mentioned, which I forgot what it was. Anyway, all right.
Empiricism debate tomorrow.
There you go. It's that. Everyone, go see that. Yeah. On with the shameless plugs, in no particular order. I see, looks like Kevin has a mouthful of beverage. Perfect time. Kevin, you're up. Tell us how great you are.
Music, please.
I could be a waiter.
Let me just, everybody, let me tell you about myself right now. My name is Kevin. And I'll take you to heaven.
My name is Kevin. I am one of the two co-hosts of the This Week in News with Kevin and Benedict podcast. I'm also an associate producer of CanadasNews.com. A bunch of stuff I do. I got my podcast. You can listen to that on iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher. You can also listen to it on the Canadas News website if you don't have a handy-dandy smartphone. I have a bunch of news pieces I write for Canadas News. I do my own little YouTube videos when I have time. I did one of the March for Trump protest in Berkeley. I was there and filmed a whole bunch of it, put it together into a video on the Canadas News YouTube channel. I will be there for the inevitable protest when Ann Coulter is going to be here at UC Berkeley.
Ouch.
Yeah. That one should be fun. But nice. Yeah, I cover all the news. If you guys have any hot news tips, drop me a line. Check out all of our stuff on Twitter. I am at Kev and Benedict. You can find us on Facebook as well. Make sure to follow Canadas News and go to my Patreon, patreon.com/ Kevin and Benedict, where you can become a patron for as little as $1 a month and get free stuff like bonus episodes, mentions on the show, extras, lots of good stuff you can do there. We're adding more stuff every single day. So make sure and follow us.
That was an absolutely rocking shameless plug. I like it. Tau Ceti Alpha, my friend. I would like you to I would like you to tell us not only how great you are, but tell us about your most recent video that you put out. Please do. Please go ahead.
Okay. I've been doing for a couple of months videos about flat earthers, showing the greatest mind of the flat earth, and that's pretty much it. You have to see it to believe it.
Indeed.
I just like the oxymoron.
So that's pretty much it. I go at Tau City Alpha for the channel and bring your mid glows, a beer, some popcorn, and remove all breakable objects near you, and it will be fine.
Yes, and you might want to sit a little back from your computer too, so you do not damage the screen. As I when listening to some of your subject matter that you've chosen, one often feels the need to punch the screen. So everybody go to Tau City Alpha's channel. It rocks.
Especially the one released yesterday. Sometimes you have the really good...
Indeed.
You know that I hate to plug my stuff.
Well, keep in mind, Tau, most of us know how great you are. It's just for new folks who may not know. Those are the only folks we're informing. Everybody else here already knows how great your videos are. So,
well, thank you.
It's not that big a deal. Just think you have a very small audience, and it's your duty to let them know where they need to go to see these videos. You're doing a public service.
So I said duty.
Duty. All right. Mole, you there?
Yo.
Tell us how cool you are.
I'm not very cool, but...
He's lying. He's lying. I know him. He's uber cool. With the umlaut.
No, not cool at all. Just have opinions that don't matter like everybody else.
Okay. All right. Moving down the list, we got RJ, who... The reason you don't hear him flipping through books with all the knowledge he puts out is because he puts out books with all the knowledge he's coming out with. So, RJ, why don't you tell us about you and how we can help you to do what you do?
Oh, gosh, yeah, I'm a shameless plugger here. My Troubles in Paradise project is shredding creationism and anti-evolutionism on a scale like nobody has done before. And Conatus, you need to buy my book because I got a really nice section in there on Ann Coulter and her views on evolution that I rake her over the coals on.
I literally talked about her on the podcast today, and we just went through reading her own quotes. That's all you need to do with that woman to show how stupid she is.
Yeah, she stepped on my turf because of the fact that she bumped into the reptile mammal transition stuff. I've got tortukan.wordpress.com, which is my main website, and you can find links to my books there. You can find links to the GoFundMe, where I am a desperately needing more people in the crowd to come in and support. I'd love to see the crowd. I've only got like 125 people so far who have actually come forward on that. I know there are more people on the planet that might think what I'm doing is worthwhile, and I'd like to be able to keep at it and stay alive. In the book department, Evolution Slam Dunk fills a huge hole in the apologetic literature, transition science, and a complete coverage of every single anti-evolutionist who's ever bumped into the reptile-mammal transition. So anybody getting that book, reading it through, will be ahead of the game. You will know every possible counter-argument that they could throw at you because I go into all of them. And nobody's done anti-creationist apologetics in quite this way before, of trying to have it as a comprehensive structure. And that's what I'm also doing at the tip site. I welcome comments and questions. I've started to do some videos, which I've got at a YouTube channel on there. And I'm slugging away because I'm on Social Security. I'm doing this as a midlife crisis in my 60s, trying to make a living at it. And everybody who can come in can actually help on this. I know it's hard going on these things, all the Patreons and stuff. Everybody's clamoring and to get a new T-shirt or the latest little cat picture that goes up that distracts everybody's attentions like laser pointers. But I can really use the support out there, gang. I really can.
And he really deserves it. All right. RJ, we'll do what we can. And all right, moving on here. Hopefully M is still awake. Am I allowed to say Mason, or do I have to just say M? M, wake the fuck up. Oh, sorry.
Either works. Hello.
M.
Yeah, let's keep it clean.
I'm sorry.
M or asshole works.
There could all right, be children listening at this hour.
Tell everybody how cool you are. Just, I mean, like anybody doesn't know, but for anybody that doesn't, tell everybody how cool you are.
Yeah, I just do little IT projects on the side. I'm just a little tech guy doing a little, like, startup company. Ooh. On the west coast of Canada, middle of nowhere. Just ordered a endoscope and a Geiger counter today, actually.
Nice.
I could do a Twitch stream with it, but I'm also broke and having fun with that as well. I'm getting a website up.
Are we allowed to mention hacker extraordinaire, or do we have to keep that quiet?
I'm a hacker? What?
I was wondering if we're allowed to mention hacker extraordinaire, or do we have to keep that quiet? If we got to keep it quiet, internet, if you're listening, don't say anything about that. Thanks.
All right. I don't know about that one.
Of course not. Of course not. All right. Very good.
Oh, I do have to jump in. I do have to jump in to remark that Urs has a thing up there about relating to what I just said. It could be that some antivirus programs mark Tortukan as malicious website. I had trouble to get it to open a PDF when I looked first. I haven't been aware of that part. I've got a mirror site of just tortukan.com where I've got HTMLs of a lot of the modules up there for people that are on iPhones or some things where they have troubles with PDFs. But anyway, all the material up on the Tortukan site, the main one in PDF format, is all free to share. Everybody can make use of them. There shouldn't be any viruses attached to any of them. They should be clean. But at any rate, I thought I should call attention to that, and I'm sorry for interrupting.
Not at all. Not at all. Good point. All right. Down the list. Paul, tell us about
I just want to assure everyone that I, too, am virus-free.
Excellent. So, you know,
as far as you know.
What get is checked. Things that Kent Hovind can't say?
lots of stuff going on, but the main thing, my channel, YouTube channel, Paulogia, Paulogia, where I normally take on the Ken Hams and the Eric Hovinds of the world, including a personal spat on air with on Facebook with Eric Hovind earlier this week, which I'm wrapping up the video on, where he and I got into it a little bit, which was fun.
Nice.
The other main project involving a lot of people in the room is Genesis History debunking series that is coming soon. So subscribe to everyone. Yeah, there you go.
Indeed, subscribe to everyone.
I think next week we should all plug the person to our left.
That works.
In your song, Paul, for ham and eggs is a worm ear. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Yeah. All righty. So everybody go subscribe to Paul if you're not already. I can't imagine that being the case. But if you're not, go ahead. All righty. And next, and we have Sean. Sean, tell us once again how cool you actually are and all about your channel.
Well, after hearing a couple of the people in here, I feel kind of horribly inadequate at this point.
Not at all. We've seen your stuff. Go ahead.
But I'm kind of a jack of all trades. You can know my channel. My name is Sean Hufford. I started out with making time lapses from a satellite called Himawari 8. Because Flat Earth is always claiming that, you know, pictures from space don't exist. And I moved on to making music parodies out of MIDIs that I've made in karaoke style. Oh, yeah, that's fun. Then I started to do backyard experiments that somebody can build with a Walmart paycheck to either disprove or prove a flat earth. And so far, nobody has actually been able to prove it yet. And I've kind of branched out and started to touch on some Nibiru stuff. And now I'm back to one specific flat earther that just doesn't know how to take evidence for what it is.
Nice.
Yeah, I kind of covered a lot of things.
Didn't Hovind do a couple of backyard experiments while in prison? I'm sorry. All right.
No, those are backdoor experiments.
Bravo, oh, I knew Bravo. I knew it was something like that.
You're feeding the guy straight lines, my.
All right. So anybody who hasn't gone to see the work Sean's doing, you're missing a lot. I recommend you do so.
I highly recommend looking at the parody list. It gets rather funny.
Alrighty. That's everybody. And it's me. I got a Patreon. Don't go there. If you have a choice between going to Patreon and just showing up for these live broadcasts, just show up. I'd rather
wait,
see
if it. If I pay Patreon, I don't have to show up? Is that what you're saying?
That's yes, but you are, I actually have paid them to block you so that you have to show up.
Okay, gotcha.
So that you have to show up.
If money's burning a hole in your pocket on the Patreon and you can't do it there, come to my site.
It's all yours, RJ. It's all yours.
Yes, help out RJ. He puts out a tremendous amount of information for free. And that should be rewarded. I agree.
I can't even print things. No ink.
As if, all right. Well, that about wraps. Okay. And I just ran out of words there. All right. That being the case, I believe it is time to bring on the pug in the closing tune. So,
got your pug
right here.
Show us your pug.
Everybody on the panel, thank you very much for joining once again. Everybody watching and commenting, thank you. I definitely appreciate you coming. I wasn't kidding. Just showing up is all we ask. Here comes the pug. All right, isn't now the time for the commentary that, like, we pretend that we think the microphones are off?
Yeah.
God, our viewers are so fucking stupid. I mean, how did they not know that Earth is really flat?
We should make the whole show psychic cloak, don't you think?
They should know we're all a bunch of crazy shows, right?
We're part of the government. I sure as hell didn't get mine. Whoa.
Me either. Oh, I got new speakers for Bob the Wonder Jeep, and I have played the Pug song at top volume. It is truly an adventure. Oh! And I went to a meeting of the Red Bank Humanists. I gotta plug them in the description of the video as well. And I mentioned some to two of the people there about the channel, and I just happened to mention Buster the Atheist Pug, and the two of them, it was a couple, a young couple, they pointed at me and said, "That's you?" I was amazed. Little tiny Side Strike channel. I'm out in the big world, and someone points at me and says, "That's you."
It's funny how the internet works like that.
Did they identify you?
I'm doxxed. I'm doxxed.
And I'm the pug.
The pug life, man.
Zai hasn't been wanting to tell us he's actually Jeff Bezos.
Oh, wait, best part of the song. This is where you hit the gas and go 140.
Kind of reminds me of Rush.
Yeah. Good night, everybody. Thanks for coming. Appreciate you sticking with us this late at night. And with Hovind, for God's sake.
I'm sorry. Yeah, it's Hovind.
It was too easy.